Good afternoon. It's Natalie Pike live from Wembley. Thank you so much for joining us today. I'm going to be with you from now until 7 p.m. We do have Talking Balls at 6 p.m. as well, of course, where the lovely Gaz Drinkwater will be joining me then. But we're setting the scene for the weekend ahead. A fantastic weekend ahead. A huge weekend for Manchester as City take on United in the FA Cup final. So we are currently sat in the White Horse pub. It is just backing on to Wembley. So when you kind of walk out and you have a look to the left, you can see Wembley. And the atmosphere is definitely starting to build in here already. I think give it a couple of hours and I think there'll be a full-on party atmosphere in here. Blues, Reds, if you're travelling down to London today, you are very welcome to come and join us. We are round the corner from Wembley and we will be here until 7 p.m. And we'd love for you to come and say hi to us and have a chat. Now, we've got loads coming up in the next 4 hours. But first of all, shortly, we will be speaking to our Joe McGrath and our Gaz Drinkwater. And we're going to set them a London-specific challenge. Quite honestly, I'm just going to get them out of the pub so I have to stop looking at their red faces, getting all giddy and excited. And we're going to send them off and we're going to get them lost in London. But we'll tell you all about that very, very shortly. We've got some cracking music coming up as well, as always. We've got some Top Loader, some Fairground Attraction and some Jonas Brothers. So thank you so much for joining me. Thank you for being with us this afternoon. We'll be through with you until 6 p.m. when Talking Balls takes over until 7. It is FA Cup Final Eve on BBC Radio Manchester. And to get this party well and truly started, here's some Lizzo with To Be Loved.
Sheesh. Girl, I'm about to have a panic attack. I did the work, it didn't work. It hurts, goddamn it hurts. That lovey-dovey was not a fan of it. I'm good with my friends, I don't want a man, girl. I'm in my bed, I'm way too fine to be here alone. On other hand, I know my worth. And now he calling me, why do I feel like this? What happened to me? Oh, oh, oh. Supposed to love somebody else when I don't like myself, like, ooh, guess I better learn to like this, ooh, it might take my whole life just to do. He called me Melly, he squeezed my belly, I'm too embarrassed to say I like it. Girl, is this my boo? That's why I'm asking you, cause you know I've been through. Let me know. Yeah.
I'm dancing around at Wembley this afternoon. That was Lizzo on BBC Radio Manchester. We are starting our FA Cup final build-up this weekend. We're going to be here all afternoon from 2 until 7pm live from the White Horse Pub in Wembley. Feel free to come and join us. Blues Reds, if you are travelling down south today and you'd like to come and join us, we'd love to meet you. Now, currently, I've got to tell you, there is two young men currently acting like toddlers sat in front of me.
Where?
That are pulling faces and putting their fingers up their noses and added at the noses there. Gaz Drinkwater and Joe McGraw, good afternoon.
How you doing, Nat?
Afternoon, Natalie.
I'm good. Why are you trying to make me laugh when I'm saying hello to everybody?
Well, we're just trying to put you off by doing a silly funny face. Did it work?
It did a little bit, to be honest. Of course, the hosts of the Devil's Advocate podcast, BBC Radio Manchester's Manchester United podcast. Gaz, how are you feeling, my love?
What, in life in general or about Manchester United?
Both, whatever you want. In life in general,
I'm all right. Manchester United, I'm not all right.
Okay,
no, I'm very
that?
Nervous. I'm trying not to think about it, even though literally I walk outside and I see a big arch and that instantly reminds me that it's final day tomorrow.
Are you nervous, Joe?
Do you know what? I will be nervous, I say, about half an hour before kickoff. But what I'm trying to do, Nat, and I think a lot of United fans and City fans are trying to do, is just make the most of the time from now till the kickoff. Just enjoy it. Enjoy the fact that we're going head to head. Enjoy these moments here where we're sat having a chat, because these are the ones we'll remember. So I'm very excited, but yes, half an hour before kickoff, I will be bricking it.
I would love some tips, by the way. I'm to be honest, I'm really glad that we're here. We're going to be here until 7pm because it takes my mind off the actual nerves for the game. Because Gaz, you've seen me, I get hysterical before a derby game, don't I? The nerves take over.
You got hysterical after the last one.
Of course I did.
You weren't too happy then, were you?
No, of course I did. We were absolutely not only robbed.
We were good that day, weren't we?
You know who was really good that day? The linesman.
Really good that day.
He had a great game.
Right. Anyway, I could keep talking to the two of you, but I'd rather not. So I'm going to kick you out of the pub. How do you think?
Can we go on an adventure? Is that what you're saying?
I am going to send you both on an adventure far away from me.
When I go to London, I ain't gonna lie, I get lost all day. Should we go and get lost in London?
Yeah, we're gonna go and do. We've got a little quiz, Nat. We've basically written a little quiz. And the little quiz is essentially us, me and Gaz, running out and about across London, and then the listeners have to guess where we are. We'll give you a couple of clues each. You're gonna have to try and figure it out as well. It's all go.
Right, so we're calling it. I wish we had a fantasy jingle. Wait, hold on a second. It's Gaz and Joe get lost in London. I'm going to send them off now. So we're at Wembley.
Right, you ready?
Right.
I'm going.
Gaz, Joe, leave. Goodbye. Get kicked out of the pub. See ya. Scran, off they go. Right, it is 2:15. I'm kicking them out of the pub at Wembley. They are going somewhere in London via public transport. They've got a contactless card each, and that is all we've given them, and a charged up mobile phone. They're off. 2:15, they're heading to a famous landmark in London. When they get there, they're going to ring us. Do you know what? Is anybody else feeling slightly nervous that this is not going to work? I feel like they might just end up in another place where they can eat and drink, and maybe they might be lying to us. So we're going to quiz them whenever they get to where they're going, and we're going to try and work out where they are, and then I want your help to let me know, to try and work out where they are. So, as always, it's 0800 218 2255 if you'd like to call. Any suggestions where you think they might be heading, 81333, start your text with the word Manc. And of course, the joke that I've been waiting to say all day is two United fans off to their native London. Well, they've left now, they've gone. So they will give us a ring when they get to their first London landmark. We'll try and work out what it is, and then we'll send them off to their next one. Gaz and Joe get lost in London. Honestly, what could go wrong? Let's have some more music. This is Top Loader on BBC.
This Caucasian is persuading people to dance till the breaks he's playing. Yo, to all the ladies and gents, believers and the non-convinced, and to the adamant lovers of defense, and those that don't recognize.
Judge it by the weight of this praise, and not by the color of shade. This is man-made corruption. Arizona heat production is not in remission of nothing. And judging by the way that you heard the technique, you seek the L.A. street, sweet, slick, talking unique. My man, terrorize, spin the fly definition on the blend when you listen to him. And just in case you're trying to outpace the verse with no dirt on your burial verse, we're relentless. Mixes unidentified physics and bona fide quickness make the turntable pivot. You got to get with it. We don't talk it, we live it.
Yo, let's do this.
Listen to this. Come on.
Come on.
Do it.
To make on the beat Omega, a freak by nature, flavor on paper, still catch papers, impressed from the minute presented, we get fresh. We provided the urge, step up and get served, reunited like peaches and herb. We speaking the word, we bringing the vibe, we setting the trend, we holding the throne. Oh my God, here we go again. Hot in position from the beginning, you listen to the brother with the description, poetic pulp fiction, spitting a killer rendition, turning citizens to victims with the writer's ambition and vocabulary diction. Cause I came to specify the rest of my televised, killing up you other guys, ain't no need to compromise. Still couldn't get it if I slowed down to say just
stop and listen to the DJ.
Check this out.
I'm so invisible because I got that back.
Now throw your hands up and reach for the part of the sky you can't touch. And if you're in the back, you need to step up front. And if you can't hear it, then tell them to turn it up. What the hell are you waiting for? Everybody in here on the dance floor, your hands in the air, and that's what's up. Cause I'm on the mic, cause E-Trip is on the cut. Your car with it, it's authentic. It's like don't stop, get it, the right combo, collaboration and combo, the way to make a brother drop the bomb, yo, from the minute that they announce me, cause I'm quick to grab the mic and say peace to Romanowski, and to all those that doubt me, or wouldn't allow me, yo, it ain't about me, it's about the kid that I know, that's one of the illest primal spinners across vinyl, best at blending the rare and taking you there and holding you down and making sure you're feeling it now with the tight bass sound. To all the others, man, it's over now, pack your bags, get your record, start rolling out. And if you still think that you should wear the crown, it ain't happening. Doc here, E-Trip, break it down.
I apologise to the people in the Whitehorse Pub at Wembley who have just heard me singing Dancing in the Moonlight at the top of my voice and also doing some shocking mum dancing, sort of shuffling round my seat. Because we are live! We are down in London today as we start our FA Cup preparations. Of course, the big one, City take on United tomorrow. FA Cup final, you'll get your full match commentary, of course, on BBC Radio Manchester with Mike Mainay. And I know that a lot of Blues and a lot of Reds are travelling south today. And we've got Paula on the line. Paula from Atherton.
Hi.
And are you, Paula?
Yeah.
Are you on your way?
No, not yet. I'm just waiting for my husband to finish work and then we're travelling down tonight. We're travelling to Boreham Wood. Yeah. We're stopping over at Boreham Wood and then hopefully getting some kind of overground or underground tomorrow from a station.
Lovely. So you're making a full weekend of it?
Yeah. I'm just so glad that Dave beat... on the quiz this morning, beat Joe McGrath.
Do you know what?
I said to my mum yesterday, my mum said, I bet a red goes on tomorrow and tries to win. I went, I don't know. But when I heard him this morning, I thought he's going to win it, but he didn't.
When I heard, Paula, that Joe was a bit embarrassed.
Oh, yeah, yeah. He showed his true colours. Because there was an Everton fan on in the week, earlier on in the week, and he said, oh, I can't say Man City because they've no history. So I thought, well, you've got egg on your face as well. I wish they'd got relegated.
Oh, Paula, I love you. Paula's, of course, talking about Manchester Mastermind, which is on Anna with Breakfast every day. We had Joe McGrath from the Devil's Advocate podcast on this morning, who was rubbish. Paula, hopefully that is setting the tone for United being rubbish tomorrow.
Exactly, yeah. Blues are on the up.
How are you feeling? How are the nerves?
Nerves, very nervous, yeah. We're travelling down with my husband, my daughter and her son, so I just hope we do it for a little boy because he's in a class full of Reds, even in Aberton, they're taking over, so...
Really?
You know,
how old is he?
Yeah, he's 7, but you know, to do something in the community, in Wigan and stuff, so he's, you know, it's character building, but they're doing okay, aren't they? I said, even if we don't win, just tell them we're still champions of England.
Exactly. I love that. I love that, Paula. Well, thank you. Thank you so much for giving us a ring. What time do you think you're setting off?
Hopefully about 5-6.
Well, I hope that the traffic is good for you. I hope your journey's nice and easy down south.
Okay, thanks, Natalie. All the best.
Give us a score prediction, Paula.
3-1, City.
3-1 to City. Thank you so much. That was Paula in Atherton. If you'd like to give us a ring, tell us what your travel plans are. When are you setting off? Come on, Reds. You need to represent now after Paula's said that. 0800 218 2255. Give us a ring. Get on air and let me know, how are you travelling down? When are you coming? Who are you travelling with? All of your FA Cup build-up right here on BBC Radio Manchester. And now some travel news for you, and there's queues, but all lanes are open again on the M60. That's heading clockwise from Junction 11 for Barton to Junction 12 for the Eccles Interchange. That's after an earlier breakdown. In Farnworth, the traffic lights aren't working on Long Causeway at Bolton Road, which means it's heavy. And it's heavier than usual on the A57 Hyde Road and Mottram Moor at Mottram in Longendale. It's taking 45 minutes to get through there at the moment. Looking further afield, the queues on the M6 going south at Sandbach Services after an earlier accident. So that's definitely one to take note for everybody that is coming down south. And on public transport, disruption to trains across England for most rail companies, with no service on some routes or severely reduced services. That is between 7 and 7 due to strike action today. That is your BBC Radio Manchester travel. More in 20 minutes.
The FA Cup Final, 1996.
Manchester United against Liverpool.
We have a great motivation now, Liverpool, simply the fact that everyone's expecting us to meet the double.
It's such an important game for the club, and we want to go to the final and try and win it.
To the young lads who have come in this season, you know, I don't think they need any advice, really. They've shown that they've got the temperament for big games, and you know, they don't get any bigger than the FA Cup Final.
The 1996 FA Cup Final remains goalless as Beckham prepares to swing it over right-footed. James comes again. This time he's lost it. Cantona shot! Cantona has scored for Manchester United! Yes! Magnificent goal by Eric Cantona!
David Beckham, FA Cup winner, how do you feel?
Absolutely marvellous. It's a dream come true, you know, winning the double.
The bunting is billowing and Wembley is a little corner of Manchester.
The FA Cup Final live on BBC Radio Manchester and BBC Sounds.
Half-hearted love affairs. I need someone who really cares. Life is too short to play silly games. I've promised myself I won't do that again. It's got to be mistakes. They're much too easy.
to give their love away. Well, I have been foolish too many times. Now I'm determined, I'm gonna get.
Perfect by Fairground Attraction on BBC Radio Manchester. It's Natalie in for Dave Scott today, live from the White Horse Pub at Wembley. We're going to be here till 7 p.m. And Blues Reds, if you're travelling down south, you're very welcome to come and join us today. Come and say hello. Now, I thought we are obviously on the full FA Cup build-up here. Reds and Blues, we've already spoken to a Blue on the phone. We've already sent our Reds, Gaz and Joe, off into London. And I thought what we could do with is getting a nice view from a neutral. Let's see what the neutrals are thinking ahead of this FA Cup final. So we've spoken, we've grabbed Dave here. Hi, Dave. Good afternoon.
Hi, Natalie. How are you?
I'm good. Wait, as soon as you start asking me, my stomach starts to jump and the nerves start coming in. But you are a Londoner. You're from Yorkshire. You support Derby County. You now live in London. So I figure you are the perfect person to give us a Londoner slash neutral view on the game. Is that fair?
It is. And as you say, as a Derby fan, playing in the FA Cup final is a foreign country to me. I've no experience of it, no expectation of it ever happening. So I'm entirely neutral.
Now, before we ask you about that, I do want to ask you about this wonderful shirt that you're wearing. Could you describe your shirt for everybody?
So it's a very old-fashioned-looking football shirt with a collar, button-up lapels, proper cuffs like a gentleman wears. And it's actually a replica of the shirt that Derby wore the last time they played in the FA Cup final, which was all the way back in 1946.
It looks fantastic. We were all admiring it when you came in before. Yes, as you say, maybe we may sitting United fans maybe starting to take this as a you know, we're getting used to being in the FA Cup final. But for someone that supports a team that hasn't been, what does the FA Cup mean to you?
So I think it's changed over years a little bit. So it used to mean, when I was a kid, certainly like a full live football game on the television, which you didn't get so much then, and it was all exciting because you could sit and watch it, and there was all the build up. I think now it means a great day out. It means a game where, as much as both teams want to win, it's not a huge downside if they lose, dare I say. It's not like losing a playoff final or, without making you more nervous, Natalie, losing a Champions League final, dare I say. It's a day out, and it should be exciting. I think it's a shame when two big teams get into it, actually. I think it's nice when some of the smaller teams get a go. But it'd be a great game to watch. Really good players on both teams. Really looking forward to it.
So as a neutral, David, you're looking forward to watching it. Give us your kind of opinion of the fact that City are United in it. Does it, to a neutral, to somebody from outside Manchester, is that a big deal?
I think it is. I think it's two proper old, well-established teams, proper old, well-established clubs. It's what the FA Cup ought to be. I think I'd rather that than kind of, dare I say, a Newcastle who've kind of spent a lot of money and haven't quite got the same profile as the Manchester teams. And we can enjoy the sort of local rivalry from the outside.
Oh, okay, yes. So what do you expect? I mean, London's going to turn a sea of red / blue this weekend. What are you kind of expecting from the fans? Do you think it's going to be... Are you expecting to be loud as you walk around? Lots of shirts, red and blue shirts everywhere?
Unfortunately, there's always a lot of red shirts in London anyway. But we all know that. I think it'll be exciting. It'll be different. I think what you won't get, which you perhaps get when some of the smaller teams get to Wembley, is hordes of people in Trafalgar Square kind of taking over the city. I think, dare I say, City United fans are used to playing at Wembley fairly regularly. But again, it'll be a great game. And there's a lot of players on both teams that people like. You know, people like Marcus Rashford, people like Kevin De Bruyne, people like Kyle Walker, I think. It's the sort of players that you want to see in big games.
I love that. See, this is why I thought it would be fascinating to speak to somebody that's a neutral, because you're excited to see the players from both teams. And I guess, are you excited then to hopefully see a really good game of football?
Basically, yeah. So I've not really got a dog in the fight, as they say. I know there's a big thing about where the City can get the treble this year. I would just like to see the good players play well. You know, I'd like to see Rashford score. I'd like to see Kevin De Bruyne do his thing. I suspect Haaland will score whether I like it or not. It's just the sort of players that you want to see on big occasions and for big games.
Yeah, absolutely. It really is. Although, for when I talk about it, when Gaz talks about it, the nerves take over. I'd love to be in a position where you're just excited to watch it. So give us a neutral's point of view. What sort of game do you think we're going to have? Who's going to come out on top?
So I think it'll be tighter than people perhaps think. I don't think City will run through United the way they ran through Real Madrid a couple of weeks ago. I think it might be 2-1 City, possibly a late winner. I would like to see Marcus Rashford score. I love Marcus Rashford. He's kind of genuinely like, I remember saying to someone, imagine how proud you'd be if you were Marcus Rashford's mum. You know, he seems like the nicest man in the entire world, and he's brilliant at football.
Yes, and he's a Manchester lad as well.
And he's a proper Manchester lad. He's not been bought in, not come for the money. I'd like to see Rashford do well. I think City will probably sneak it, but I think it'll be tighter than Istanbul. I think that might be, in a funny way, the easier game for City.
Oh, I still can't think about next week, you know, David. I really can't. I think the United fans will be happy hearing you say that, because from that, I'm taking that you think United are better than Real Madrid.
I think United probably are better than Real Madrid at the minute. I think they've got the younger players. They're at the start of a cycle, not the end of a cycle, I think. They're not better than Real Madrid were in their heyday, of course, but I think they're on the way up now, and Madrid are probably on the way down for a couple of years.
I think the United fans are going to be very happy, very, very happy that you're saying that. So what does your weekend look like then? How will the FA Cup final fit into your weekend?
So it'll probably fit in a similar environment to where we are now, so in a pub-based environment. It's great that it's back on at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. This nonsense when they played it on the same day as league games in the evening. No. It should be like the only game of the weekend.
So agree.
It should be on the BBC from 8 o'clock in the morning. There should be people on the team buses.
Yay!
Like the old days now. Like the old days. Not this newfangled nonsense.
I'm with you, David. Do you miss the songs? Because I used to love the FA Cup final songs. For our younger listeners, the teams that got into the FA Cup final used to make a song.
Yep, and people used to buy it. That was even more bizarrely.
Didn't
one of the United ones get to number one?
I feel like it did, and I feel like if Gaz was here, he'd probably start singing "Come On You Reds." I think that was it. I'd never live it down.
It was
David.
That one. But yeah, that I remember. It was a big thing. The players used to sing it. They didn't
they
get like actual singers.
Right.
And people actually pay good money to buy them.
Oh my goodness.
It's bizarre.
Yes. And the suits. They used to get special FA Cup suits as well.
Yes. Well, of course, the Liverpool ones as well. Where
the
they
white
look
ones.
Like ice cream men.
Yes, the white ones. I'll always remember.
And then
those.
Lost to United. Was it Cantona? Did Cantona score that game, I think?
He probably did.
Almost certainly. It was that time, sort of time. So, yeah, I think it should be back to being a proper big occasion. It shouldn't be an afterthought. It should be a big game in and of itself. That's what I'm looking forward to tomorrow.
I think that's absolutely brilliant. On the BBC from 8 a.m. in the morning, people on the buses, songs back, suits back. Yes, I love it, David. I've sold it. Let's put you in control of the FA Cup. Thank you so much for coming and talking to us today.
It's been awesome. Thanks for inviting me.
Thank you so much. It's really wonderful to have somebody, because for the rest of the day, all we're basically going to have is Blues saying they're going to win, Reds saying that maybe they're going to win. We'll find out. But it's lovely to have a neutral down. David, thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
So we are down in the White Horse Pub at Wembley. We're going to be here until 7 p.m. tonight, giving you all of your FA Cup final build up. You are very, very welcome to join. Travelling down, we'd love to hear from you. 0800 218 2255. You can text us 81333. Start your text with the word Manx. So very shortly, we're going to be finding out where Gaz and Joe have first got lost in London. But before that, let's have some more music. This is Waffle House. Travel news for you. And in Farnworth, the traffic lights aren't working on Long Causeway at Bolton Road, which means it's heavy. Outwood Road is closed from Wimslow Road to Cross Road, that's in Hill Green Cheadle, because of a fire at a building. Now, looking further afield, there are queues building on the M6 going south at Sandbach Services after an earlier accident. The A6 is closed between the car garage and the Peakdale turnoff in Buxton because of an accident. And of course, looking at the public transport networks, disruption to trains across England for most rail companies today due to strike action. And that is your BBC Radio Manchester Travel.
The FA Cup Final 2011.
Manchester City versus Stoke.
Plays it back into Balotelli, deflected out, almost comes to seven. There's a chance in it! Yaya Toure scores the goal! He scored the winner against Manchester United in the semi-final. Has he going to do it again in the final? Manchester City 1, Stoke City 0.
Great occasion for the whole club, for the fans, everyone involved in Manchester City.
You know, I'm just 22 and I've won my first FA Cup. It's just unbelievable feeling, man.
Manchester City's 35 years of pain are ended. They won a trophy again for the first time since 1976.
I'm happy for the supporters. For them. I'm happy for them. They deserve to win this cup.
Now the FA Cup is held aloft by Carlos Tevez. Manchester City are the FA Cup winners 2011.
The FA Cup final live on BBC Radio Manchester and BBC Sounds.
Sleep at night. Everything I think about makes me feel like a version of myself. They tell their lies and we all synchronize. Look to the sky because it's almost over. We want the truth. Give us the absolute. We need your help cause we've got nothing. We want the truth. Give us the
From the White Horse Pub near Wembley. We're going to be here until 7 p.m. tonight. Of course, you've also got Talking Balls with myself and Gaz from 6 till 7 with your full FA Cup build-up. We're going to just give you the exact coverage, the exact build-up, everything you need to know from now until the game tomorrow, and then you get your full match build-up tomorrow, full match commentary with Mike Miney. FA Cup final, what a weekend for Manchester. So I brought down with me today Joe McGrath and Gaz Drinkwater. They're from the Devil's Advocate podcast, a Manchester United podcast. You can get that now on BBC Sounds. And I didn't want to keep looking at their faces in the pub, so I kicked them out. We've sent them to get lost in London. So hopefully they're on the line now. Joe, Gaz, are you there?
Oh, can you hear us? Me and Gaz are here. Out we go.
Secret location.
Secret location. I can tell you, we hopped on the tube to one of London's very prestigious places. I was going to give a clue, then away, but I didn't want to give a clue. We it's a bit of a lovely day in London. The skies are blue. I can tell you there's a very busy scene of people here of where we actually are. They've all just left this attraction. We've got two clues to give you. I'm going to tell you the first one and hand the phone to Gaz. Clue number one, Nat.
Okay, we're ready for you, Joe.
Okay, you may have seen one of London's most famous fictional characters, Where I Am Right Now.
And I'll give you clue number two as well, Nat. It's just a phrase, it's as simple as this. The game is afoot.
Say that again.
The game is afoot.
The game is afoot.
The game is afoot.
A force?
Oh, a foot. The game is a foot.
Why does he keep saying this? What's going on?
I don't know what you're saying. I can't understand you. The game is a foot. Oh.
Wow. Honestly.
Gaz, I'm sorry. I won't be the only one, though. Right. So, we've sent them out into London. So, they were at Wembley. They left at 2:15. They've gone off on a tube and they've got off. So, Joe and Gaz are lost in London. But where are they? So, give us those clues again, lads.
So the first clue from Joe was that one of London's most popular fictional characters, you may have seen him knocking about this particular street. Well, I've also given a bit more away there. I've said street.
You're on a street. You're on a street. Okay.
Okay. Okay. Right. The second clue, the game is afoot.
I don't understand that clue. Afoot.
Well, that's because you don't read, Nat. That's because you don't read.
Oh, right. Okay, well, there's another clue. Okay, where are Joe and Gaz? Let us know. Let's work it out together. Let's try and get them unlost. Or we could just leave them, to be honest. That would be great. It's 0800-218-2255. You can text us 81333. Start your text with the word Mank. Where in London are Joe and Gaz? Right, are you waiting there for us to work it out, or are you going somewhere else?
No. What we're going to do is we're going to go to a second location. Whilst everyone texts in where we are, then we reveal where we were. Because London's so popular, we've got to keep going to these locations.
All right, keep going.
So we're on the move. We're on the move somewhere else now. But we'll reveal where we were here when we come back to you later on.
Right, but hold on. Before you leave, Joe and Gaz, before you leave, I want a picture. Oh, you two. I want proof. I want to know that you're not just in a pub round the corner from here. Get a picture.
Oh, yeah, we need to get a picture, Gaz. Quick, go back.
Get a picture. We need proof. The boss wants proof.
We're back, everyone.
Right, we'll speak to them very, very shortly, Joe and Gaz, lost in London. Now, Manchester City's last FA Cup final was against Watford 4 years ago. This is how the Blues made it back to Wembley this time around.
And Manchester City will be back here in June for the FA Cup final. Yeah. Riyad Mahrez, left-footed, brilliant penalty. Down the middle, into the roof of the net. Hello, round four of the FA Cup. Manchester City 4-0.
Yeah, first versus second in the Premier League. City versus Arsenal. It's the FA Cup fourth round at the Etihad tonight.
Grealish twisting and turning. Tries to find Nathan Ake. He might go for goal! Nathan Ake for Manchester City! Manchester City 1, Arsenal 0.
Ake's played exceptionally well.
Honestly, it was beautiful. I enjoyed every single minute of that.
Could this be a catalyst? They've won a really tough game tonight. Can they now carry this forward for the rest of the season?
Manchester City looking to seal the deal with Kevin De Bruyne. Oh, brilliant finish from Kevin De Bruyne into the bottom right-hand corner. I'll tell you where Manchester City are, into the quarter-finals of the FA Cup. Bristol City 0, Manchester City 3.
How much is the FA Cup a target for Manchester City this season?
Yeah, a massive target. You know, we swapped out, we've not really won it for a while, and we would really like to win it this year and try our best, and we're going in the right direction.
Another opportunity! It is six of the very best for Manchester City! And what a way to get to an FA Cup semi-final. City 6, Burnley 0.
Yeah, we have to perform. We have to perform every single game because the last couple of games has been finals. And that's exactly what we've been doing. I'm proud and happy. I don't know what more to say.
To another level. Grealish is the one who goes into the penalty area. Looks for the option. Mahrez hat-trick. Riyad Mahrez. A game for Manchester City. Manchester City can enjoy an FA Cup semi-final at Wembley for the first time in 4 years. Manchester City 3, Sheffield United 0.
goodness, the goosebumps I'm feeling already. The FA Cup final is upon us. I've been trying to forget about it, honestly, since the semi-final, since that Sheffield United game. Well, indeed, since United played Brighton, and I knew it was going to be a Manchester derby. But it's here. It's tomorrow, and we are already down at Wembley. We're going to be here all afternoon. If you, you know, if you're heading down south, you're very welcome to come and join us. Or indeed, we'd love to know what your journey's like. When are you coming down? Are you travelling today? Who are you coming with? Are you on a coach? Is someone driving? 0800 218 2255, or you can text us 81333. Start your text with the word Manc. Now, Reds, don't worry, we will be after the news doing your road to Wembley as well, of course, covering all Reds, all Blues here on BBC Radio Manchester. And we will be doing Talking Balls from the pub a little bit later as well. That is from 6 till 7pm, where I'm sure we'll be getting into some fierce and hot debate with Gaz, who, by the way, Reds, he's been getting more and more confident all week long. I mean, 2 weeks ago, he just couldn't even think about the FA Cup final, and now he's getting more and more confident. So Talking Balls from 6 till 7pm. And of course, I'll be here with you up until then as well and through till 7pm. It's BBC Radio Manchester. Thank you so much for giving us your company this afternoon. We so do appreciate it. It's so lovely to have your company, and hopefully we will give you that FA Cup feeling, get you nice and excited. Let's all try and calm the nerves together, shall we? That would be nice. And, you know, if you know as well, we've had a text in from Jez. He knows where they are lost in London. We'll be doing Joe and Gaz Lost in London again just after the news as well. But before that, let's have another song, shall we? This is After All.
I'm not afraid to
FA Cup final.
It's a sensational blockbuster tie.
City v United.
Oh, Rodri, head out to Rashford.
Tomorrow on BBC Radio Manchester and BBC Sounds.
Summer of 69, Bryan Adams. It's Natalie Pike in for Dave Scott on BBC Radio Manchester. I'll be here with you through until 6 p.m. And then, of course, we'll have Talking Balls with Gaz from 6 till 7 p.m. So thank you so much for joining us this afternoon, wherever you are, whatever you are doing, if you are in work, if you are travelling, if you're on your way down south for the FA Cup final. Thank you so much for joining me today. Now, two fans who are looking forward to this weekend, they only met each other 6 years ago. Martin Hibbett was injured in the Manchester Arena bombing, which killed 22 people in 2018. Paul Harvey was instrumental in making sure Martin survived. And Martin promised he'd take Paul to Wembley if United ever got to an FA Cup final. And they certainly have. And we're joined now by Martin. Good afternoon, Martin. How are you?
Good afternoon, Natalie. I'm very well, thank you. How are you?
I'm good, although the nerves are starting to kick in. Now,
yeah,
did you ever think you'd see the day United were back in FA Cup final?
No, well, I didn't think it had come around so quickly, and obviously it's almost like our second home this season. This will be my third trip to Wembley in the space of, 3 months? So it's kind of a bit of a dreamland at the minute, but I'm a bit like you today. I'm just trying to keep busy so I don't think about tomorrow, but it'll soon be upon us.
Now, when you start to think about it, do the nerves start to kick in? Is your belly starting to jump?
Butterflies and, I probably won't sleep tonight. And, really, really nervous. So, I just try and keep busy.
I didn't sleep very well last night, Martin.
No, I know. I hate it. It's the one thing I hate about cup finals, just the anticipation and the nerves and the what ifs and looking at the team news and interviews. It just makes it even worse.
And do you think is it even worse this year because it's the derby as well, because it's City versus United?
Yeah, there's all that, isn't it? It's obviously a derby, cup final. They could potentially do a treble, you know what I mean? So there's lots riding on it. But like I say, I'm just trying to not think about it. So thanks, Natalie.
No, I'm sorry. Honestly, Martin, I've been trying to delay it since the semi-finals, but it's here. It seems to have come round so quick. So remind us, what did you promise Paul?
So obviously Paul's the paramedic that saved my life, and I promised him two things. I'd take him to United to watch a game, which I've done several times, but I said that if we got to an FA Cup final that I'd take him. And then when we got to the semi-final, I had a bit of a dilemma. I thought, do I wait to the final, or what about if we don't go, or what if we don't beat Brighton? So I ended up taking him to the semi-final just to be safe. And then obviously we beat Brighton, and then I could obviously repay the favour. So tomorrow is the day that, I mean, it's taken me 6 years, but obviously the 6 year anniversary was last Monday, so it's probably come at a nice time actually. I repay kind of the promise that I made kind of just over 6 years ago to Paul. It's going to be a lovely day, and obviously tomorrow is going to be emotional anyway, but for me and Paul, it's going to be more than football tomorrow.
Martin, I just love the fact that you and Paul have become friends now. I mean, is it football, or does it go beyond football? Are you just like watching, like going cinema and stuff as well?
Honestly, we're good friends. And actually, it's a weird one, because I took my neurosurgeon to the game against Chelsea last Thursday. So the guy that literally operated on me for 14 hours,
wow,
I've become good friends with him. And, and obviously the two of the team that climbed Kilimanjaro last year looked after me in major trauma. So I know a lot of people from Salford Royal, and you know, everybody that knows me knows that Salford Royal is a very special place, as are the people. But there are four special relationships there. Obviously, Paul the paramedic, Anka Saxena, the neurosurgeon, and then Stuart and Caroline, who were both nurses on the major trauma ward, were literally like family. And it's a lovely story, and for something so beautiful to come out of such an awful night, it's the thing that we all talk about. It's, you know, such a wonderful thing to come out of such a bad night, and we love each other very much.
Oh, Martin, it's such a beautiful, beautiful story. I'm so happy for that you've met made these close friends after everything that happened. Now, when are you travelling down?
So I'm picking, but I've told Paul it's going to be an early start tomorrow, but obviously being a paramedic, you should be used to it now. But if you, I think you'll be listening. I said I'd be on. So if you're listening, don't forget, put your alarm on, Paul.
I'm going to be up in the morning.
I'm going to be up at 5 o'clock. I'm picking Paul up at 6:15. And then we've got to be, I think the coach leaves at, I want to say 7:15 from Old Trafford. So hopefully we'll get there with plenty of time. But I think it's going to be carnage on the roads tomorrow. So I'm kind of bracing myself for a few traffic jams. And I don't think we're stopping off either. Normally we stop off at a service station, but I'm led to believe that the police have stopped. I don't know if I'm wrong, but I believe that we're just going to be going straight there, so there'll be no pit stop.
Oh my goodness, what if you need toilet, Martin?
Well, exactly. So
I hope there's one on the coach for you.
But there'll be. I won't be drinking much tea. Let's put it that way.
Well, Do you know what? I'm going to check that out because I'm sure I heard that there was some service stations were open, but for certain sets of fans. So I tell you what, I'll put producer Rebecca on the case and we'll try and find out and we'll let everybody know. We'll make sure everybody knows because, you won't want to be having a couple of cups of tea in the morning if you've got to get all the way to Wembley. But go on, Martin. You're a red, we know that. But give us your match prediction.
Oh, I don't normally do much predictions. You're putting me properly on the spot now. Do I have to do it?
No, I'm not going to force you. You can. You don't have to.
I'm going to say I never do. Especially, I never do it. So sorry for being a party pooper, but
not at all.
It's just a thing that I never do predictions. So if you don't mind, I'm going to because again, if I say we'll win, and it just puts the heebie-jeebies on it, and I don't want to do that.
Well, I predict whatever happens, you're going to have a wonderful day with Paul.
Well, that's it. And do you know what? And I've said that. You know, given what we've done this season, and you know, obviously finishing third, a Carabao Cup, you know, I'll take it. You know, there's obviously other things that we need to do, which we won't get into today in terms of our owners and things like that. But yeah, good transfer window in the summer. And then hopefully, you know, we can really start to make a real improvement now.
Have you got any superstitions, Martin? Like, have you got lucky socks that you might be wearing to the game?
Do you know what? I have got a superstition, to be fair, I do it pretty much before every home game. But it's what I did when I first went to my first match when I was seven. I folded all my clothes. I picked out what I was going to wear, and I folded it all up and put it at the side of my bed. So I do that before every match I go to. So,
I love it.
And so I've done it for like 40 years. So, bless her, my wife's washed all my clothes ready, so they'll be all ready to be folded, ready for me to wear in the morning. So I just do that. I just fold what I'm going to wear in a nice little pile, pretty much like I did when I was seven. And I still do that now as a 46-year-old. I'm sad to say.
Oh, Martin, I love that. We've all got our different superstitions. I used to have a pair of blue leggings that I used to wear, and then we got beat by Wigan in the FA Cup final about 10 years ago, and the leggings went in the bin. So I think we've all got them. We certainly have.
Yeah, I haven't got blue leggings, so I can't do that one, unfortunately. But yes, folded clothes is as far as I'll go.
Folded clothes. Well, you make sure they're nice and crisp tonight then, so you have a lovely start to the day. And thank you so much for coming on and talking to us. Always a pleasure to hear
Anytime.
You on BBC Radio.
Yeah, no, it's always great. Thanks for your continued support of me and everything that I do. Always a pleasure to speak to you.
And send our love to Paul and your other incredible friends that you've made through Salford Royal. Have a wonderful...
Thank you
And
so
do you know
much.
What? I'm going to say, Martin, have an absolutely wonderful day. But obviously, I don't want United to win, but have a wonderful day.
I will. Thank you. And you too. Take care.
Thanks so much. Thanks. That was Martin Hibbert, who is, of course, a Manchester United fan. And he's travelling tomorrow down to the game with Paul, who he met 6 years ago. Just Martin's story, you'll have heard it here on BBC Radio Manchester, is just phenomenal, and just what an inspiration he is, and what fantastic people he's met. And it's just so lovely to hear about these beautiful friendships that have come out of such a tragic incident. So I hope Martin has a wonderful, wonderful day tomorrow. Now, producer Rebecca's been on the hunt, find out information about the service stations. And she says, the service stations are on the United City websites. So there is specific service stations. You're driving down the motorways tomorrow, you're a blue or a red, you're only allowed in certain service stations. So have a look on the City and United websites before you travel is the best advice I can give you. Now, Gaz and Joe are still lost in London. So a little bit earlier, we sent Gaz Drinkwater and Joe McGrath of the Devil's Advocate podcast out into London. They went to visit some of London's best landmarks, and we want you to help us work out where the heck are they. So we've already had one right guessing. Jez Havoc has said, hey Nat, they're at... And yes, they are there. Jez has given me the right answer. Do you know where they were? They told us they were on a street that was one of London's most famous landmarks. And then Gaz told us something that made no sense to me. The game is afoot. I had to get him to repeat that. The game is afoot. Do you know what that means? 81333, start your text with the word Manc. Let me know, where are Gaz and Joe lost in London? Now, Manchester United are looking to win the FA Cup for a 13th time tomorrow. This is how the Reds made it back to Wembley.
And United are going back to Wembley! Marcus Rashford from up, sends the keeper the wrong way and sends Manchester United into the fourth round. Manchester United 3, Everton 1.
How are you feeling about United's hopes in the FA Cup?
Yeah, I think why not? I think we're on a good run of form.
Corner taken quickly, Bruno into Fred! Lovely back heel! Manchester United 3, Reading 0.
I think the only thing that Eric will be a bit disappointed is that it wasn't 6-1.
Balls to Fred! 3-1 to Manchester United, and United are into the FA Cup quarter-finals.
We're not going to get carried away, but the character that they're showing, they never look beaten. To go a goal down, it would have been easy to roll over. And in the over the last few years, they might have rolled over. But the way things are at the minute, the character amongst the group, it was great to see yet again.
It's challenging. It's a chance. It's 1-0 to Fulham. Mitrovic is there. Oh, wow. The Fulham manager, Marco Silva's been sent off here. He's got a red card.
Willian's in serious trouble here. Referee's going back onto the pitch now. So, you know, we'll see what Willian's fate is going to be now.
He's penalty given. It looks like the red card's coming out. The red card is out.
And he's off.
Willian is off. Mitrovic has approached the referee.
He's gone.
And Mitrovic has received a red card here.
Wow.
Three red cards in 5 minutes.
Wow.
Fernandes! United are going back to Wembley for the second time this season. It's Manchester United 3, Fulham 1.
With very good players on the ball, but especially with a good mentality and with a good team spirit in the dressing room. I think you can see it on the pitch. We give it all for everyone.
Victor Lindelof to step up for United and put them into the FA Cup final. Will we have a Manchester Derby final? Yes, we will! Victor Lindelof scores in the top right-hand corner and United are going back to Wembley after winning at Wembley for the second time this season.
Oh, Reds, I bet you've got goosebumps now after hearing that. Yes, you are back at Wembley. Another visit to Wembley for you this season. Blues, Reds, if you're travelling down, travel safely. Have a wonderful trip down. We're already here. We're at Wembley. We are at the White Horse Pub. I'm going to be with you until 7 p.m. this evening. We've also got Joe and Gaz. We've sent them out into London. Congratulations to Jez and to Ian, who've correctly guessed their first location in London. We're going to get them back on the phone very shortly. They'll tell you where they were and where they've moved on to. If you think you know where they are, the clue they gave us was the game is afoot and it is a London street they're on. 81333, start your text with the word Manc. Now, here's some updated travel news. In Farnworth, the traffic lights aren't working on Long Causeway at Bolton Road, which means it's heavy. Outwood Road is closed from Wimslow Road to Cross Road in Heal Green Cheadle because of a fire at a building. And looking further ahead, there are queues on the M6 going south. That's at Sandbach Services after an earlier accident. The A6 is also closed between the car garage and the Peakdale turnoff in Buxton because of an accident. And looking at the public transport network, of course, the disruption to trains across England for most rail companies due to strike action today. That's your BBC Radio Manchester Travel. We'll give you more in 20 minutes.
The FA Cup Final, 1999.
Manchester United against Newcastle.
Sheringham in possession, reverse pass for Scholes. Scholes looks for Sheringham. Sheringham puts United 1-0 up. Teddy Sheringham with a wonderful goal.
For Teddy, it's a pleasing, very pleasing moment from some point because he must be saying to himself that this is my last chance, really, you know.
I knew I was going to come on at some stage. The manager made that quite clear. To come on after 6 minutes, you're just thrown in. It's as if you're playing from the start.
Sheringham to Paul Scholes. Scholes has made it 2-0. Manchester United 2, Newcastle 0.
When I came here, the treble was always on. We're 2/3 of the way there.
You know, hopefully we can do it on Wednesday as well.
Now, only Bayern Munich can prevent Alex Ferguson from writing his name in history with that incredible treble.
The FA Cup Final live on BBC Radio Manchester and BBC Sounds.
As soon as the goons hit the building, you know the boys. My team hit the spot and make it hot like Corduroys. Pump JP, O'Brien, and Sly Polaroid. We don't play no games. Check out the ride, then come check out the diamonds. The papers in my nature, players gotta stay shining, shining. Get out the way when I'm driving the lane, because we don't play no games. From the tip off to the last basket scored, I'ma get big, penetrate and crash the boards. I shoot, I barely miss. If I put it in the air, I bet you all you hear is swish. You can double team, go and put your D on high pressure. Still take off or pull up for the trifecta. I got your defense so shook. They don't know if I'm a dunk, pull up for the J or throw a no look. Think I'm joking and find out. I just went on a 10-0 run. You best to call a timeout. All the fans in the building might stare when I do this new move and juke you out your gym shoes. If he ever play ya, you gon' think I cheated. Got a team full of creative players. I'm a hustler, just give me the ball, it's on. I'll shake you out that man or shoot you out of that zone. Come on, soon as the goons hit the building, you know the boys. My team hit the spot and make it hot like Cobra Boys. Whoop JP, O'Brien, and Sly Polaroid. We don't play no games. Check out the ride, then come check out the diamonds. The papers in my nature, players gotta stay shining, shining. Get out the way when I'm driving the lane, because we don't play no games. He's been thinking, he's been hoping. He can guard Bumpy Johnson, but he's open. Better double team him. Watch the coach, cause if I hit slime the post, then it's over. We can play one-on-one. I don't know who gassed you. I got a deadly first step. I'll blow right past you. On defense, I got them hands. And on offense, I got handles like pots and pans. Get some game, you ain't got you any. You couldn't win if I picked the worst team and spot you 20. I can't stop, I'm on the roll. And I'm nuts at home, but I put up numbers on the road. Get the rock, you won't get a shot. You shoot, shoot fast. I put them on the glass like Mix-a-Lot. I get the... I got a six-man that can shoot it from half court. As soon as the goons hit the building, you know the boys. My team hit the spot and make it hot like Cobra Boys. Whoop JP, O'Brien, and Sly Polaroid. We don't play no games. Check out the ride, then come check out the diamonds. The papers in my nature, players gotta stay shining, shining. Get out the way when I'm driving the lane, because we don't play no games. Yeah, game over. It's your man, the rookie of the year, Bunk J. Don't pass me the rock, I'm a...
You're joining us on BBC Radio Manchester live from the White Horse Pub at Wembley. We are going to be here until 7 p.m. and of course you'll get all of your FA Cup final build-up here on BBC Radio Manchester and your full match commentary of the FA Cup final with Mike Miney as City take on United. We've got Joe and we've got Gaz lost in London somewhere. Very shortly we'll bring them back on to find out where they were and where they are now. You've still got a chance to guess. The game is afoot. That was the clue for some street in London that they have gone to. 81333, start your text with the word Manc. And we are getting photo proof, by the way. They've just sent me a picture. They were actually there. They've moved on somewhere else now. We'll get them joining us very shortly. But right now, I'm very excited because I'm joined by a City fan in the pub who has travelled, well, it's fair to say, halfway around the world to be here today. Jeremy, thank you for joining us.
Well, thank you. I'm so happy to be on Radio Manchester.
Now, we can immediately tell that is not a Manc or indeed a Cockney accent. Tell everybody, where are you from?
So I'm from North Carolina in the United States. It's in the southern part of the United States. Our people that have not been there, halfway between Miami and New York City.
Oh, wow, that is a good description. Okay, that definitely helps. And you've traveled over here with your family to watch the FA Cup final.
Not just the FA Cup final. We have a little bit of business to take care of in Turkey next week as well.
I love that. So are you going to Turkey and then coming back here, or do you go home from Istanbul?
I actually support our national team. Don't ask me who I would pick between City and the United States of America when they play, because it would be City. But we actually start up our national play. I think I've called up the rosters, and we have a big rival. We play Mexico in Las Vegas. So we're actually flying from Turkey to Las Vegas to see the Yanks take on the Mexicans.
That is one of the best football trips I think I've ever heard in my life. So you're going North Carolina to London to watch the FA Cup final at Wembley, to Istanbul to watch the Champions League final with City and Milan, and then you're going from there back across to America to watch your national team take on a rival Mexico. Wow. That is an incredible football trip.
Well, it is only the... they've decided to follow Europe, and now we have a Nations League North America. So not exactly a friendly. They're never friendlies between U.S. and Mexico, but not exactly a big trophy either for CONCACAF.
But still, you never want to get beaten by your rivals, no matter what you're playing in. A friendly game between City and United, and I would want City to win, obviously. But you are a lifelong, or a Blue for a long time, you were telling me. When did you start supporting City, and how? How did you find us?
So I started supporting City back in 2002. And I would say I wasn't City till I die until 2006.
Okay.
But in 2002, we had the World Cup. And the United States, that's the best we've ever done. We actually beat our rivals Mexico in the Japan and Korea World Cup and went to the quarterfinals. Matter of fact, we didn't even make it in 2018. But that was the peak at that time of U.S. soccer. And I use that association football term only because y'all gave it to us. It's football to us. To most of U.S. fans, it's football to us, too.
Okay.
But after that, I said, well, there was barely a professional league in the States at that time. And I said to my friend, I have nothing to watch. I watched every match. I got up at 2 and 3 in the morning at the time. And at that time, I thought that was kind of crazy. But I watched all the matches because I was studying for my bar exam. I'm a barrister. And at that time, I was out of university and studying for my exam. I watched every match, and I had nothing more to watch. And I said, there's no more to watch for 4 years. And he said, well, why don't you pick a team in Europe?
Okay.
In Europe, everybody, that's what they watch. They watch football, and it's every year.
All the time.
They have the domestic league. They have the Champions League. They have cups. You pick one of those. And I said, well, what should I pick? He goes, well, you speak English, so pick a team in England. You don't speak German. I said, all right. I don't know anything about English football. He says, pick a team and follow him for 1 year, and you tell me that it hasn't impacted your life. And I should tell you, he was a Newcastle fan at the time.
Oh, he's happy now then, I'm sure.
Well, it was the Shearer time back when he was...
He was happy then as well, yes. He's had a dip in the middle.
It has been quite a long journey for him, yes, that's for sure.
Okay.
So he said, pick a team. I said, well, I don't know anything about English football, but I don't like that pretty guy. Where did he play? And he said, that's David Beckham. He played for Manchester United. He plays for Madrid now, but that's David Beckham. I said, oh, I don't like that guy. And I've heard of that Manchester United. I don't like them at all either. I said, that's like the New York Yankees. They win all the time, don't they? He's like, yes. I said, wait a minute. That guy that quit on Ireland, Roy Keane, didn't he play for them too? He goes, yes. I said, oh, I hate that team.
And so who are their rivals?
I said, who hates Manchester United in England? He goes, well, every team hates Manchester United. And I said, well, what team hates him the worst? And he goes, there's two. Liverpool hates him the worst, and Manchester City hates him also. And I said, well, is Liverpool good? And my friend says, well, they've won the most championships in the history of English football. I go, well, I don't cheer for teams that win that much. I only cheer for teams that lose. Is Manchester City good? He goes, oh, God, no. They'll never win a trophy. So I asked if the fans supported him. Do they go to the same? He said, oh, yeah, they show up at the stadium. They cheer for him. He goes, but it's a roller coaster team. And I didn't understand what that meant at the time. He goes, but if you cheer for them, you'll suffer a lot. And he was right.
And you thought, suffering, that's the team for me.
Well, my university team plays American football and American basketball, also notorious for not winning most of the time and losing in spectacular fashion. But nothing could prepare me for the life of typical City. Nothing could prepare me for that.
But Jeremy, how are you coping now that City are winning everything? This must be hard for you.
So, honestly, it's wonderful. I'm here. I'm excited to be going. But I think that I honestly think I enjoyed it more. Certainly 93-20 when Aguero scored. I'll never forget that. It's one of the greatest moments of my life. I'll never forget that. I'll get tears in my eyes thinking about that now. 2014, you know... But I think back, like, I remember when we first got into Europe, from the fair play rule. We don't have that in America. The fair play rule.
We got the least red and yellow card, so we got into Europe. I remember that.
Yeah, we had Richard Dunn out there. How do we make that?
Those were the days. Oh, my goodness, Jeremy. I had no idea what you were going to say. I love asking people how they became a City fan. Are you okay? Can you stick around? Because I'd love to hear more from you about your thoughts and life as a City fan in North Carolina.
I don't even think we can check into our hotel yet.
Perfect, then. Jeremy's with us all afternoon. Jeremy, thank you so much. So Jeremy's a City fan that's travelled over from North Carolina for the FA Cup final. Then he's off to the Champions League, and then he's back to watch America versus Mexico. It's the best football trip I think I've ever, ever heard of. Now, we've got two Manx who are on a trip out in London just now. In fact, they are lost in London. Joe and Gaz, are you there? Joe and Gaz, are you lost? Are you there? No, they've gone. They're lost. They're well and truly lost, right? We'll try and get Joe and Gaz back on the phone in just a second, and they'll tell us where they have been. Oh, are they there?
Yes, we are here. Can you hear us?
Yeah, I was worried because your phone wasn't working there, and I thought they're actually lost.
No, we just got lost in London. We actually are lost, but only in London now.
Okay, right, Joe, you've been somewhere, and Jez and Ian both guessed right. So tell us, where was the first place you went to visit?
Right, Joe, give me a drum roll. Come on. Ooh. 221B Baker Street, a.k.a. the home of Sherlock Holmes.
Yes, we're Sherlock Holmes, and we got our inspector suits on. We were loving life.
Well done, lads. I should have got that. Gaz, what was the game is afoot? What does that mean?
That's his catchphrase. That's what he used to say. Sherlock Holmes said the game is afoot.
Okay, well, you can tell I've never watched that or heard that in my life because I still can't quite understand what you're saying. Right, so where have you moved on to? What did you do? Did you get on a tube or did you walk?
Right, so we headed on the Jubilee line, and I can tell you that we're at one of London's busiest attractions. It is absolutely rammed here with the blue sunshine across London. I can tell you my clue is this. It is one of the most expensive properties in the world. In fact, an American report once said that if someone was to buy this place, and I don't think you can, it'd be worth over £1 billion now.
What?
Yes. Think of properties. Okay. Think of,
so you were, yeah, on, they were at, they were at Baker Street. They've now got on a tube. They've got off somewhere in London that is worth over £1 billion if it was Jubilee to be line. Sold. Have you got anything for us, Gaz? You got anything to add?
I can tell you that this place that we're at right now has recently had a new head of residency.
A new head of residency. It costs over £1 billion. Where are Joe McGraw and Gaz Drinkwater of the Devil's Advocate podcast lost in London? Let us know. 81333. Start your text with the word Manc or give us a call. 0800 218 2255. Let's find out where they are. Let's help them out, shall we? Right, lads, off to the next place, please, and get photo evidence.
We're off. See you later, Nat. Bye, everyone.
See you later. Oh, where are they?
Someone
come on.
The
we can still hear yous. We can still hear yous. That's Joe and Gaz. They're lost in London somewhere. Now, we've had a text in, and I absolutely love this. Can you believe this? It says, hi, Natalie. Our daughter Jess from Stockport is currently working a shift in the White Horse pub. She's at uni in Wembley and is a huge United fan. Unfortunately, the White Horse is a city pub for the day tomorrow. Yes, it is indeed. Please, can you say hello to her from Mum, Dad, Rosie and Reggie? Right, well, we are in the White Horse pub at Wembley, so I'm going to go off and I'm going to try and find Jess from Stockport, who's the United fan, and we'll try and have a chat with her. And also, we're going to keep catching up with Jeremy, the City fan that's come all the way from North Carolina as well. We're having such a fantastic day. Thank you so much for joining us on BBC Radio Manchester. Now, this is I'll Be There For You.
I'll be there.
France on BBC Radio Manchester really got me dancing around the Whitehorse pub down at Wembley as we build up to the FA Cup final. Coming up, we'll give you some more info on where Gaz and Joe are lost in London. If you think you know, 81333, start your text with the word Manc. But now, some more track news. There's a breakdown on the M62 heading west from Junction 12, the Eccles Interchange turn-off, to Junction 11, the Birchwood turn-off. This one lane closed and it's heavy. In Farnworth, the traffic lights aren't working on Long Causeway at Bolton Road, which means it is heavy. There are queues on the A57 Hyde Road and Mottram Moor at Mottram in Longendale. Current travel time is 30 minutes there. In Hollingworth, there are queues on the A628 Market Street. That's at Gun Inn traffic lights, meaning a travel time of between 35 and 40 minutes along there. There's congestion to the M67 at Tintwistle. Traffic is also slow through Woolley Bridge and Mottram as traffic queues to try and join the A628. There's been a fire at a building that has closed Outwood Road in Hill Green Cheadle. That's from Wimsow Road to Cross Road. And looking further afield, there are queues on the M6 going south at Sandbach Services after an earlier accident. That's your BBC Radio Manchester travel. We'll have more in 20 minutes.
The FA Cup Final
2013.
Manchester City v Wigan Athletic.
Baby, you saw me standing.
Straight away, we got through to the final. Roberto, the first words he said to me was, "You must lead the team out at Wembley."
The feeling that we're going to have in the FA Cup is playing without fear, with nothing to lose.
In comes the corner for Wigan Athletic, and it's gone!
That you can't describe the feeling that we got at this moment. I can't be any prouder than them.
This is the day, the greatest day in Wigan Athletic's history. Wigan Athletic in the cup final 1, Manchester City 0.
The FA Cup final live on BBC Radio Manchester and BBC Sounds.
Radio Manchester, Natalie Pike here, standing in for Dave Scott. And we've come south for the weekend. We are at the Whitehorse Pub in Wembley as we look forward and we look ahead and we look nervous and we let our stomachs jump and give ourselves goosebumps thinking about the FA Cup final tomorrow. Now, we brought Joe and we brought Gaz with us from the Devil's Advocate podcast, but we sent them out into London to get lost, to find some famous landmarks, and then to give us clues about where they are. Now, the first one was Baker Street. They gave us clues on the second one, and we've got Hilary in Whitefield on the line who thinks she knows where they are. Good afternoon, Hilary.
Good afternoon, Nat. First of all, I think it might be Buckingham Palace.
Ooh, now, What's made you think that?
Because a new head of residence, because the Queen passed away and Charles took over as King.
They did say a new head of residence, and they did say it was worth more than £1 billion. So that would make sense. We're going to get them back on in about 10 minutes, and they'll tell us. But Hilary, I think that's a good shout.
Before you go, FA Cup final, well, you know I'm a true blue like you.
Of course.
And I can't watch it tomorrow for religious reasons, so I've got a dilemma whether to watch it as live later on and try not to know the score. But then if United win, I've wasted 2 hours of my life. But if City win, then I don't want to know until I watch it. And I just hope it can go to penalties because our goalies don't save them.
So what do you think you'll do then? Are you just going to try and stay away from news, stay away from your phone?
Yeah, because as soon as I turn my phone back on, it'll. I don't know. I'll see how I'm doing. But I was actually fine. I've been really relaxed until talking balls this week, and it's made me a wreck.
Hilary, I'm exactly the same. I'm fine until I start talking about it.
But I agree with a lot of what was said when you were at the museum. I couldn't come because I couldn't get there in time from work, but I would love to have met you all. And I just think I all the United fans at work today were saying that if City are on their top game and play like they did against Bayern, they think they're going to get absolutely hammered. But I don't think so, because they've got the opportunity to win two. Yes, it's the FA Cup final, but there's extra spice because of it's City United. There's even more spice on that because of what it means to both teams in terms of treble and stopping trebles. And it means United would have, we would have the double so far, and and United would have both cups, which I don't want them to have. So it's more than just a Derby Cup final because of everything else that's involved with it and what it means. But I said a joke to one of today. I said it would be typical City to beat United and lose the Champions League because we all think that's almost a foregone. I was being flippant. I was being flippant because it would just be typical City. But and I'm glad we've got the referee in the Champions League final that we've got. But I just want him to find room for Foden because I love Jack Grealish. But Foden scores more goals. He runs at players. He can beat players. He scored a hat-trick. And I wish you could find room for both of them in the team, but I don't know who you take out.
Me too, Hilary. I completely agree with you. I love Phil Foden and I love Jack Grealish, and I think they've both been fantastic. But do you know what? It's a wonderful problem to have. But Hilary, thank you so much for calling today. Give us a ring on Talking Balls as well. It's always lovely to speak to you, and we really, really appreciate you listening and you calling in. So thank you so much. That's Hilary in Whitefield. She's had a guess on where Joe and Gaz are lost in London. She thinks they're in Buckingham Palace. Now, we've also had a guess. Jez Havoc, who's a United fan, he's got it right. Lee the Jolly Blues got it right. Ian in Collyhurst said, is it Mayfair? Not quite, Ian. And Will from Stockport says it's Green Park Tube Station. Not quite right either, Will. But if you think you know, it's 81333, start your text with the word Manc, or it's 0800 218 2255, and we'll get Joe and Gaz back on the line in just a couple of minutes. Now, we're in the White Horse Pub at Wembley, and I am joined by a City fan who is currently on what I'm calling the greatest ever football trip that I have ever heard of. It's Jeremy from North Carolina, who's over with his family. He's watching the FA Cup final, then he's flying and watching the Champions League final, and then he's flying and he's watching his home nation take on Mexico. Jeremy, thank you for sticking around with us.
Thank you, Natalie. I'm glad to be back.
So we heard all about why you became a City fan, which is just the most wonderful story. But tell us, what is it like to be a City fan now in North Carolina? What time are you getting up to watch the game? And is there more of you now? How many Blues are there in North Carolina?
So I think when I started, I didn't know anyone. It took me years to find a City fan in North Carolina. But now there are two official supporters clubs, one 90 minutes away from my home and one another, 2 hours away, two supporters clubs, one in Raleigh and Charlotte.
When Americans say that, it always sounds far for us, by the way, but I feel like you're saying 2 hours is like just popping down the road.
Well, I don't know. I'm flying out of Stansted Airport, and I thought that was in London, but I was clearly wrong.
So you've got two supporters clubs that are close to you. Do you get together with them to watch all the games?
So I'm a member of the Raleigh Supporters Club, and I've been there only two or three times. But my daughter lives in Chicago, and the Chicago Supporters Club has been around for years. They probably have 40 to 50 people to watch the matches.
Wow, that's fantastic. Can you see more blue shirts where, like, around in where you are now?
anywhere in America, what people I don't think understand that are, I'm a legacy fan. They talk about legacy fans now. I'm a legacy fan because I've been there forever. I might not have grown up there, but I can remember when we had nothing. Matter of fact, I can remember when I learned a term, we were skint.
Yes.
I didn't know what that was, but that was very bad.
We were, and we are not now.
We are not skint now. But now you are just as likely to see, my nephew is five, he's in first grade, and you're just as likely to see somebody wearing a Man City shirt than you are to see somebody wearing a United shirt or a Barcelona shirt. The kids that are growing up now, whether you want to call them plastic or you know, glory hunters, they watch good football and they see it. And they don't even remember sometimes when Man United was winning trophies. They don't remember when Arsenal's Invincibles. I mean, that's been 20 years from now.
I have a five-year-old, Jeremy. The first game he ever went to, City won 8-0. So he's no idea.
Well, it's a good thing he's five. He didn't go to the Borough game when we lost 8-1.
And I was there, you know. I was there. I still think it was one of the coldest football games I've ever been to. So you're here with your family as well. Have you turned them all blue?
So they put up with it, and I think they all support it. My daughter over here, when she was a freshman at university, we did go on spring break to Manchester, and we did actually get to go see City play two games. Anytime there's a game where it's we can watch a Champions League game midweek and then watch a game on the weekend, it makes it a little bit better trip for us because, as you might imagine, I don't have a lot of supporters points for road tickets.
Yes, so. I can imagine. Yes. Before we let you go and enjoy your trip, because we've hoarded you in the pub today, give us a prediction for tomorrow. What sort of game are you expecting? And if you fancy doing a score, I'm not going to force you.
No, I could say that. So every match I've ever seen City play a friendly, including when they played United in a friendly in 2017 in Houston, where we had nothing to offer, but our best player on the pitch was a young lad from Stockport at 17 years old.
Yes!
We lost 2-0. I think Lukaku scored two goals against us in that game. But every friendly I ever watched City play, they never win. They never win. Okay. They lost 3-0 the first game I saw them play Inter Milan in 2009. They never win in a friendly. But this is not a friendly.
This is not.
I would say tomorrow, with all due respect to United, they have a quality club. And, you know, they've shored up the middle of Casemiro's playing tomorrow. You know, we don't know the lineup that Pep's going to put out. But as long as he doesn't start zero defensive midfielders, a la Chelsea, Porto,
yes.
I think that we're going to win. And I would say this game, I think this game is going to be 3-1 City.
Okay, yes.
And I would favor Foden to play tomorrow.
Yeah, just like Hillary said. Right.
I would favor Foden to play. And by the way, when Hillary called in, you said it was £1 billion.
Mm-hmm.
It cost £1 billion. I was thinking for sure it was Chelsea's dressing room.
Love that, Jeremy. Thank you. It's been a real pleasure to meet you today. What are you doing now? What are you doing? Are you going to do some sightseeing during the week between the FA Cup final and the Champions League final?
So, I had hoped that we would take off and be able to get up to Manchester. Crazily enough, this is a crazy story, but I never knew I had. We're Americans. We don't know what we are. Every American is an immigrant. Every American is an immigrant, except for Native Americans. I'm sorry about that. But every American besides Native Americans are immigrants. And I learned about, 2 years ago after being a Blue for all these years, that my great-great-great-grandfather and great-great-great-grandmother immigrated to the United States from Rochdale.
Wow, Rochdale!
And so it was my goal to go to Rochdale to find where they were married and where they were born. However, it does not appear it's going to be this trip. We'll have to wait for a Champions League trip in the fall. If anyone wants to give me some tips around Rochdale.
We'll tell you all about Rochdale. That is right where we are. Jeremy, thank you so much to your family as well. I hope you have a wonderful time over and see City pick up a couple of trophies.
Well, thank you, Natalie. I appreciate it. And City till I die. Go Blues.
Yes, love that. It's Jeremy from North Carolina who's travelled over for the FA Cup final. Now, we've got Gaz and we've got Joe. They're lost in London somewhere. Gaz, Joe, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you loud and clear. Now, I hope you can hear us because we're at another amazing location here in London. It's very, very busy. But do you want Gaz to reveal where we were last time?
Right, we've had loads of guesses in, you know, Hillary and Jez and Lee the Jolly Blue. Right, tell us where you are. Well, you were.
We were at Buckingham Palace.
Yeah. Gosh, you were. Well done, lads. Well done to Hillary, to Jez, and to Lee the Jolly Blue. Right, you've moved on, have you? What did you do? Walk? Get the tube?
Oh, that's giving too much away, that. It's giving too much away.
Right. So give us the clues, then.
All right, I'll tell you that where we are, apparently, employs over 8,000 people and one cat.
Wait, say it again.
This place employs over 8,000 people and one cat.
And one cat. 8,000 people and one cat.
Right then, my other clue for you here, Radio Manchester, is that a lot of people are trying to take a picture today. Hello, sir, you all right? Of a famous front door. That's all you get from us.
Right.
They're trying to get a glimpse.
So 8,000 people, a cat, and people are trying to take a picture of a door.
Yes, that's all you get from us.
Right, what are you doing now? Are you going somewhere else? Are you coming back? It's only the gas is supposed to be on Talking Balls.
One more place and then we're going to come back.
Joe, get him back for six, because he's supposed to be working today. You're not just having a jolly, you two.
There's a lovely London pub over the road called the Red Light. We might nip in for quickly, but then we'll be back before six, you promise?
Right, be back before six. Where are Joe and Gaz? Where have they got lost in London? It's 81333. Start your text with the word Manc, or give us a call. It's 0800-218-2255. They've got one more location to go to, and then we're going to get Gaz back here in time for Talking Balls, which is 6 to 7pm. You're listening to BBC Radio Manchester. It's Natalie in for Dave Scott today, live from the White Horse Pub at Wembley, as we start the build-up for the FA Cup final. What an incredible weekend for Manchester. If you travel down now, Blues, Reds, do travel safely. Get here. The sun is starting to shine. Come and join us if you get here in time. We've got lots of great music coming up for you in the next hour as well. So thank you for joining me. Thank you so much. I love your company on BBC Radio Manchester.
Wasn't open a goal. Ah, with the middle, I'm a. make it to the playoffs, but the dream is Super Bowl.
Man, I'm out.
Lob the ball to me. My squad be bet your team is all rookies.
Light it, light up.
I form and watch the blitz.
Audible, audible.
I see a ball in they defense. Smash rock, take it straight at the gut. They can't contain me. Game is weak. We all mad. It can't be beat. Can't smoke on the back of my jersey. Gray and black. Nine to go back. Like Tom through the rack, man. Know that. Every time you touch the controller, game over. NFL, get in my lane. I run you over. Federation EA Sports, it's in the game. Grab your keys, pads, and helmets. Time to do your thing.
Monkey just showing my tail, breaking the scale, cracking the frail, deliver the ball like a postman do mail, touchdown, finna clown, dancing on the field, you know I got skills and you know your boy Trill, quarterback tied in, I'm running through them all, and I'm crushing they bones until they tumble and fall, wild boy pigskin all on the ball, diamonds on my numbers cause I love the ball, championship ring, princess cut on the top, and I'm riding to the game in a big body drop, cheerleaders on the side getting pumped for the team, the crowd yelling Twanky All-American Dream, and when it come to playoffs, I'm the MVP, that's why I'm Madden Pro Fred Eric Kruger me.
Tuck your shirt in. This ain't flag football. These tackles really be hurting. Falling on his turf feels just like the street. You better not try no quarterback sneak. I might lose the Raiders or the Niners for sure. Brand new Madden 2004. I done shook your defense. The line looks spooked. I bet you never seen a whole team get juked. Fourth and 15, they done went straight berserk. We ain't punting the ball. We going for the first. These cleats feel tight. I think they too little. I'm handing up the ball and going straight up the middle. Federation on the field, y'all better go home. It's little TJ dancing in the end zone. We all in the huddle. Y'all better listen. John Madden football in the video game system.
Thank you for joining us this afternoon. It's Natalie Biking for Dave Scott with you through till 6 p.m. And then I'll be joined by Gaz Drinkwater for Talking Balls for 6 till 7. I'm coming to you live today from the White Horse Pub in Wembley as we are looking ahead. And I am getting nervous and my stomach is starting to jump thinking about the big Manchester Derby FA Cup final tomorrow. Oh, I'm starting to get right nervous, I am. Now, we brought Joe McGrath and Gaz Drinkwater from the Devil's Advocate podcast down with us, and we've sent them out into London. They're getting lost in London. They're telling us some secret clues on where they are, and we're asking you to help us work out where they are. So, Ian in Collierhurst, Alison in Heaton Chapel, Steve in Droylston, and Jez, your third time here, Jez getting this, they've all had a guess. But what do you think it is? I think your guess looks pretty, sounds pretty good there to all of you as well. So they said that there's somewhere that employs over 8,000 people and a cat. And there's lots of people there taking pictures of a door. So where are they in London? 81333, start your text with the word man. Call, give us a bell. 0800 218 2255. So it is the 142nd FA Cup final that takes place tomorrow. And as you know by now, the first ever Manchester derby. But all eyes will be on the man of the moment.
Never, ever misses.
This man is a sensation.
Another Haaland hat-trick.
Another Haaland hat-trick. Oh, I like the sound of that. The £50 million Norwegian forward, the man who City fans will be hoping can help them win the elusive treble. Manchester United were the last team to win the Premier League, the FA Cup and the Champions League in just one season. Of course, that was back in 1999. Speaking to the BBC, Erling Haaland says he's got the Champions League in his sights.
That will mean everything. This is why they bought me, of course, to the club to get this. We don't have to hide that. So I will do everything I can. I possibly can to try to make it happen. And it's my biggest dream, and hopefully dreams do come true.
Oh, dreams do come true. What a man, what a talent. Well, joining me now is Matt Oldfield. He is the co-author of a book about Erling Haaland that's part of the Ultimate Football Heroes series for children. Afternoon, Matt. How are you, love?
Hi there, Natalie. Lovely to speak to you. Yeah, doing very well. Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us. I know all about the Ultimate Football Heroes series because I have a five-year-old. And I'm telling you, Matt, I'm so excited because he loves Erling Haaland. So this is perfect.
Oh, brilliant. Please say hi to your five-year-old for me.
I will do. And I need to get him a copy of this because he's obsessed. I mean, what do you think it is about Erling Haaland, apart from the unbelievable goal scoring, that, I mean, children, adults alike just love him?
Yeah, there's something. I mean, I go into a lot of schools as part, alongside all the books that I write. And the thing that keeps coming up and again is this whole idea of him being sort of this robot, this goal scoring machine. And I think there's something about that kids kind of like, that idea that he's kind of, you know, if you put together all the perfect parts in one footballer, he's kind of that, isn't he? You know, the speed, the height, the power, the goal scoring, the skill, like he's got everything. And it just looks kind of easy sometimes for him, doesn't it?
Yeah, I feel even though that he's like superhuman, he's very relatable. So when he put up on his social media in the last couple of weeks that he plays Minecraft, my five-year-old went crazy and he kept going, Erling Haaland plays Minecraft. So he just kind of, like you say, he makes it look easy and he is relatable. Are you finding from writing this book, like, is he as popular as you expected or even more popular?
I think so when we wrote this book, it was back when he was still at Dortmund. So he was still kind of obviously a big superstar already, but it was before the big kind of Man City wave, if you like. But he just comes across as a really, for all his obvious football talent, he comes across as just a normal kid, really. There's stories about, you know, him sleeping. He used to sleep with a hat-trick match balls in his bed when he was younger. You know, the Champions League anthem would be his morning alarm, and you know, all these kind of lovely little stories that just show how normal and human this, you know, kid with a big dream was growing up. So I think, yeah, I think, and I was recently, there's that clip with John Stones that's gone viral of him doing an impression of him and his Yorkshire accent. Yeah. And I think stuff like that is just brilliant because it kind of, as much as, you know, we think of him as this kind of goal scoring robot, he's also got this personality and this really like nice, down to earth, humble kind of style about him as well. So I think he's, as I say, the perfect mix of lots of different things.
So in terms of your book, tell us about it. Is it about his life? Is it stories about him? What can we expect from the book?
So it's a kind of biography in the classic style. So it sort of what we call from the playground to the pitch. So that journey all the way from, you know, well, for him being born in Leeds and then, you know, growing up with this love of football to becoming a superstar on the pitch and in the top leagues and everything. So it's that kind of journey, the ups and the downs and all of that stuff. But it's very much from his perspective and kind of, yeah, his journey.
Do you have any other City or United players in your mind that you might want to do in the future?
Well, so one of our next books coming out is will be Casemiro. So that's, yeah, and yeah, we already have De Bruyne and Rashford. So yeah, I'd say there's a pretty even split between City and United players within the series.
Wonderful. Matt, thank you so much for joining us today.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me and good luck in the final.
Thank you. Thank you so much. That was Matt Oldfield, who's the co-author of a book about Erling Haaland that's part of the Ultimate Football Hero series for children. I need to get that for my Reggie. Edison used to be his favourite player, but now after this season, it's well and truly Erling Haaland. So you're listening to BBC Radio Manchester. We are live from the White Horse Pub in Wembley. Shortly, we'll be hearing from Joe and Gaz again, finding out where they got lost, where are they now? And I'm hoping that Gaz gets back in time for Talking Balls at 6 o'clock, to be honest. Right, let's have some more music now. This is Chemical by Post. Chill. Chill. Slim Thugger. Boss out, go low.
We gon' get it started. We gon' get it crumb. We gon' show them boys they ain't messin' with no punks. It's about to go down, the boss run the time. They come them hogs, everybody get it started now. We gon' get it started, we gon' get it crunk. We gon' show them boys they ain't messin' with no punks. It's about to go down, the boss run the time. They come them hogs, everybody get it started now. I ain't got nothing to lose and everything to prove. So all you player-hating dudes who wanna be in my shoes. Get out of line if you choose, I make you look like fools. You can't duck these 1-2s, I'm on my P's and Q's. I move smooth like a big ship out on the cruise and brain damage. Everything I touch, I bruise. You've been listening to too much rap, it got you confused. You playing hard when really you were good at 2 shoes. You need to be yourself and quit trying so hard to amuse all them fake cake dudes that you're calling your crews. While you're trying to be me, you need to try to be you. I ain't no ordinary rapper, you can't do what I do. Hands down, I'm the big boss of the time. You ain't know, you better start asking around. I ran the game 7 years with the underground crime. And I'm still here at the top right now. We gon' get it started, we gon' get it crumb. We gon' show them boys they ain't messin' with no punks. It's about to go down, the boss run the time. They come them hogs, everybody get it started now. We gon' get it started, we gon' get it crunk. We gon' show them boys they ain't missin' with no punks. It's about to go down, the boss run the time. They come them hogs, everybody get it started now. I'm a heavyweighter, a boss in the game. Just cause you got a grill and braids don't mean we the same. Just cause you rep don't mean we get paid the same thing. You think you getting what I'm getting, you insane, man. I'm in another lane, whole other level. That's why the right foot pushing on the phantom pedal. That's why the watch got the big rocks on the bezel. There's 19 carats in my egg, still buying pebbles. I'm a big dog, you a little pup. I had a meal before the deal, chill, that's what's up. I ride around on rims, cost more than your truck. Before you battle with the boss, get your hustle up. You a nobody, you don't count to me. I'm 255, you about an ounce to me. I'm Slim Thug, I make the whole world bounce to me. No matter how you add it up, you don't amount to me. We gon' get it started, we gon' get it crumb. We gon' show them boys they ain't messin' with no punks. It's about to go down, the boss run the time. They come them hogs, everybody get it started now. We gon' get it started, we gon' get it crumb. We gon' show them boys they ain't messin' with no punks. It's about to go down, the boss run the time. They come them hogs, everybody get it started now.
On BBC Radio Manchester, it's Natalie Pike here with you down in London. We've all come south today. We had a nice early start. Mike Minay picked me up at 7:30 this morning. Gaz and Mike and I travelled down. So Mike Miner is, of course, BBC Radio Manchester's Manchester City commentator. Gaz Drinkwater is BBC Radio Manchester's Manchester United commentator. They were in the front of the car and I decided I'd just hide in the back and try and have a little nap. Now, I'm not travelling back in the car with those two. They're travelling back together on Sunday morning, just the two of them, and it keeps making me chuckle every time I think about it because it means one of them's a winner and one of them's a loser. And it's just those two in the car. And I'd absolutely love to have some sort of secret cam in to see what it's like. I feel like one of them's going to be like slumped and sad and one of them's going to be like playing cheery music all day. So I can't wait to get in the office on Monday and find out what their journey back was like. Of course, you know, you all know who I hope's singing and being cheery in that car journey. And talking of our Gaz, we've sent him off. We're keeping him busy before Talking Balls at 6 p.m. We've sent him and Joe McGrath out into the streets of London. They are lost in London and they keep phoning us, giving us clues and trying to help us work out where they are. Shout out to Ian in Collyhurst, Alison in Heaton Chapel, and Steve in Droylsden, and Jez, the United fan, who've all had a guess. Oh, and Caroline. Thank you, Caroline's got in there as well. Now, they gave us the clues that they were somewhere that employs 8,000 people and a cat. And there was lots of people there taking pictures of a door. So where are they in London? 81333, start your text with the word Manc, or give us a call, 0800 218 2255, and we'll be hearing from them very shortly about where they're lost in London. But before that, here's some more travel news. And there are queues on the M6 going north. That's from Junction 27 for Standish to Junction 30 for the M61. Travel time is currently around 30 minutes. In Farnworth, the traffic lights aren't working on Long Causeway at Bolton Road, which means it is heavy. There are queues on the A57 Hyde Road and Mottram Moor at Mottram. That's in Longindale, meaning a travel time of around 30 minutes there. And in Hollingworth, there are queues on the A628 Market Street at Gun Inn traffic lights. It's taking between 35 and 40 minutes to get through there at the moment. Congestion to the M67 and Tintwistle, and traffic is also slow through Woolley Bridge and Mottram as the traffic queues to try and join the A628. Outwood Road is closed from Wimsow Road to Cross Road in Heal Green. That's because of a fire at a building. And looking further ahead, there are queues on the M6 that's heading south at Sandbach Services after an earlier accident. And the A6 is closed between the garage and the Peakdale turnoff in Buxton. That's because of an accident. So there's a diversion in place for the bus service 190. And that's your BBC Radio Manchester travel. I'll give you more in 20 minutes.
The FA Cup Final
2016.
Manchester United beat Crystal Palace.
I want to lift a title here. The FA Cup is a title, a very important title in England, but it is much more important for the club.
Lifting back in and punching his onside into the area on the far side. Jason Puncheon has volleyed home a spectacular goal in the FA Cup final. Rooney into the box. Fellaini controls on his chest. Driven back in. It's an equaliser. And Juan Mata has smashed it home. Valencia's ball in. Comes out to the edge of the box. Lingard has scored. Jesse Lingard with a right foot finish. May well have won the FA Cup for Manchester United.
Yeah, I mean, Juan's the only one who's won it before, so for us to win it now is amazing.
It's always great, of course. You look at the fans, it's fantastic. And winning trophies lifts football clubs.
The FA Cup Final live on BBC Radio Manchester and BBC Sounds.
Still in me when
that sugar sweet. Don't let nobody touch it unless that somebody's me. I gotta be a man, there ain't no other way. Cause girl, you're hotter than a Southern California day. I don't wanna play no games, you don't gotta be afraid. Don't give me all that shot, no makeup on, that's my sugar.
Sugar by Maroon 5 on BBC Radio Manchester. People evacuated from their homes in Stockport yesterday still haven't been able to return as police continue to remove hazardous material from a house. A man's been detained under Section 4 of the Explosive Substance Act and remains in police custody. Our reporter Isabel Fry was at a press conference this afternoon with Chief Superintendent John Webster, who said he didn't believe the man detained had malicious intent to attack.
So you joined me this afternoon inside a police cordon in Middleton Road in Reddish. Yesterday morning, officers from Greater Manchester Police executed a warrant at a house, and we found what's probably best described as a substantial quantity of hazardous material. It means material which is really consistent with the industrial manufacture of fireworks, and I really want to make that clear. That's what we believe that we found here. But the reason why we have this cordon in place and the reason why we've had to evacuate the immediate area is to make sure that actually the residents and the property remain safe and we have our partners in place disposing of that hazardous material as we speak. We're trying our very, very best to do this as quickly as possible, and we absolutely appreciate the disruption that this has caused to many people in the community. As a result of the execution of the warrant yesterday, a man has been arrested. He's a 50-year-old man, as we believe he was in possession of the hazardous material that I've mentioned. We're hoping to have this matter resolved as quickly as possible. We have a information centre which is set up not far away at Reddish Library, where members of the council are there happy to explain to them what's happening and answer any questions that they may have.
How many people are displaced? And you say you want to get it sorted as quick as possible. How long can we expect them to be out of their houses?
Well, first of all, I don't know how many people are displaced. We have a cordon in place which is approximately 100 metres in diameter. I mean, clearly, we're right in the centre of a residential sort of district, you know, lots of semi-detached houses. So the number of people displaced is significant. We are fortunate that it's a sunny day, you know, and we're really grateful to family and friends for helping people, you know, and looking after them. In terms of timescales, it's difficult to say. Our priority is to keep people safe and keep property safe. You know, we're really trying hard to make that happen as quickly as possible. But I need to manage people's expectations, and I don't want to give any false promises.
You said there's no significant risk of what the material that you found. So why is it still necessary to take all these people out of their houses?
Well, the reason why there is no significant risk is because we're doing what we're doing. The reason why we've evacuated people is to make sure 100% that they are safe. We have experts behind me that are dealing with that hazardous material, and of course they're trained to do so, and we follow their advice and guidance. So it's all done in the interest of people and property.
And you described it as a sort of firework type material you found. Firework doesn't seem very threatening.
Just to put that into context, we all know what fireworks are made of. They are explosive materials. You know, it is the black powder type of stuff that we could all recognise. And when you find a house which has a substantial quantity of that type of material, I'm sure that everybody listening to this would recognise that there is a danger there, and we need to make sure that we recover it and that we dispose of it in a safe fashion, making sure that not only the police officers and our partners remain safe, but clearly the community, which is our number one priority. So rest assured, when we do release this scene, it will be 100% safe for the residents to return back to their property and to go about their lawful business.
That was Chief Superintendent John Webster, who was speaking at a press conference earlier this afternoon with our reporter, Isabel Fry. Now it's 4:30. Let's get the latest from Jade Taylorson.
Police are still at the scene of a stabbing in Droylsden this afternoon. A 44-year-old woman has died. No arrests have yet been made. Meanwhile, a police cordon is still in place in Reddish after hazardous materials were found by officers investigating the making of illegal fireworks. People living on Middleton Road have been told to stay away until the area is declared safe. A 50-year-old man is in custody. And tens of thousands of City and United fans will be travelling to Wembley tonight and tomorrow for the first ever All-Manchester FA Cup final. Drivers are being warned to expect delays, as it's feared there'll be major congestion on the roads on a day when another train strike is planned. Greater Manchester's weather, clear skies tonight and another dry and fine day tomorrow. Lows tonight of 4 Celsius.
The sound of Manchester.
Manchester.
And all.
Manchester.
Radio Manchester from the White Horse Pub at Wembley, because we are counting down to the first ever All-Manchester FA Cup final. It is City v United. Now, as I'm sure all the Reds know, Ollie Mears is a massive United fan, and he's been telling Anna Jameson that he can't wait to be at Wembley tomorrow.
The FA Cup Final, City v United, this Saturday on BBC Radio Manchester and BBC Sounds.
What an amazing moment for Manchester to have City and United in the final. It's going to be incredible. First time in its history, isn't it? Is that correct?
Yeah, never.
So it's just incredible in it for a cup final to have that. So yeah, as a United fan, of course, I'm going to be there. I'm going to be supportive of my dad. Me and my dad and my nephew will be going, yeah.
Score predictions.
You can't. Do you know what?
Is it because you don't want to say it?
No. Listen, I have belief that on any day, any team can win, no matter what the form is. You know, it's a cup final. Anything can happen. Obviously, if you look at the form guide, City are in great form at the moment, so they have to be favourites. But on our day, we've beaten them already this season at ours. So it's all or nothing, innit?
That was huge United fan Ollie Mears speaking to Anna Jameson about the FA Cup final. How is your nerves, everybody? Blues, Reds, how are you feeling? Let me know. 81333, start your message with the word man. Indeed, give us a ring. It's 0800-218-2255. We're also still giving you a couple more minutes. And honestly, it's because they actually are lost now. We don't know where Joe and Gaz currently are. We've sent them out. So Joe and Gaz from BBC Radio Manchester, they present the Devil's Advocate, our Radio Manchester, Manchester United podcast. They are out and about. We've lost them. So we're giving you a few more minutes to guess where they are. So they told you that they were somewhere that employs 8,000 people and a cat, and that lots of people were taking pictures of a door. So where are they? Get in touch now. 81333. Start your text with the word man. And hopefully very shortly, we might actually find out where they are. But before that, let's have a little bit more music. And this is Trustful by Pink.
Oh. Yeah. The bread has entered the building. The bread has entered your home, your car, your truck. Wherever we gonna do this thing, we gonna do it so death style. Yeah, so y'all get ready. What I want y'all to do is, why don't you just clap your hands, everybody? And everybody just clap your hands. And if you ready to get into the game and get your hoop on, get you an opponent to play, get your control, it's on. Live, it's NBA. See the characters fly through the sky like airwaves. I play the center or the point guard. Go hard or go home. I'm in the paint, entering in my zone. I'm being everything you ain't, so leave me alone. Consult with your coach, get your game plan together. For so long I've been doing this, never will I stop. It's whatever on the court, on the level that you not. Post up, hit a three-pointer every time. Cross over you cause you're stuck on the bench, watching me shine time. Out, don't get out of bounds now. Cause I fake a hot sauce move on it to make your bounce out. Hey, rocking the ball, keep coming in. The players wanna dribble with me. They got me running up and down the court, winning of course. It's the B to the RAT. Hey yo, I got it. Rocking the ball, keep coming in. The players wanna dribble with me. They got me running up and down the court, winning of course. It's the B to the RAT. You wanna know my stats and who run with me? You wanna get familiar with my play strategy? Well, let me tell you, it's a triple double guarantee. I'm causing trouble from half court, nothing but threes. I'm a player with a passport, it's nothing to me. I'm sassy when I swish in my uniform. This is how I get down past the meat. I'm so sick, live on stage or the court, don't miss it. I'm prolific and gifted, and I insist that you wanna assist me, cause I make hits. Been in the game since 93, don't forget. Me and JD, Jordan and Pitt, holding the championship cup. Lamping in big trucks with big wheels, it's a big deal. My dream fulfilled, posterizing myself until my time is up. For real, still surviving, sharpening up my skills. Cause I got it rocking, the ball keep coming. And the players wanna dribble with me. They got me running up and down the court, winning of course. It's the B to the RAT. Hey yo, I got it rocking, the ball keep coming. And the players wanna dribble with me. They got me running up and down the court, winning of course. It's the B to the RAT. Hey yo, I got it rocking, the ball keep coming. And the players wanna dribble with me. They got me running up and down the court, winning of course. It's the B to the RAT.
travel news. And two lanes closed and it's slow on the M6. That's heading south from junction 19 for Nutsworth to junction 18 for Middlewich. That's because of a camper van that has broken down. In Farnworth, the traffic lights aren't working on Long Causeway at Bolton Road, which means it's heavy. And it's heavier than usual on the A57 Hyde Road and Mottram Moor at Mottram in Longendale. And it's taking 45 minutes to get through there at the moment. In Hollingworth, there's queues on the A628 Market Street at Gunning traffic lights. It's taking 35 to 40 minutes to get through there. And there's congestion to the M67 and Tintwistle. Traffic is slow through Woolley Bridge and Mottram as traffic queues to try and join the A628. And Outwood Road is closed from Wimslow Road to Cross Road in Heal Green Cheadle because of a fire at a building. And that's your BBC Radio Manchester travel.
The FA Cup Final
2019.
Manchester City v Watford.
Never won the FA Cup before. It's a massive trophy here in England, and you know we've got the Carabao Cup already.
Watford and Wolves were the best, a part of the top six, the best teams.
David Silva is there. Silva shoots. Oh, David Silva has scored.
In the second half, we played great. We scored another four goals.
Kevin De Bruyne has scored. And yeah. Kevin De Bruyne may have clinched.
Of course, it was an incredible final for us, not for Watford, because at the end the result is what it is.
Raheem Sterling has scored two goals in quick succession, and Manchester City have made history. They've equaled Bury's record 6-0 scoreline in an FA Cup final.
The FA Cup Final live on BBC Radio Manchester and BBC Sounds.
The weekend is here. It's Friday and it's going to be one of the biggest weekends of the football season so far anyway. It is the 142nd FA Cup final and for the very first time it is an all Manchester affair. City take on United. Now I am in the White Horse pub at Wembley and just probably a few metres away, a couple of hundred metres, maybe a 2 or 3 minute walk. Ah, Mike Minay has only gone and got himself in Wembley early. You all right, Mike?
Yeah, I've broken in nice and early, looking splendid. It is hot pitch side, let me tell you, and I have already seen the prize they're all after. I've been within an inch of it, Natalie. The FA Cup's pitch side now, and she is shining bright in the sunshine, let me say.
Oh, Mike. Oh, I can't. So she's already there. She's ready and waiting to be picked up by a red or a blue hand.
Yeah, it's and red and blue hands to pick it up. It's got red and blue ribbons on it. Blue to the left, red to the right, draped down the side of the famous old trophy. She is ready to be lifted. But by who?
By who indeed? Now, you're already inside Wembley. I'm guessing you've got in there nice and early to beat the traffic and the crowds and everything, Mike. Well done to you. Very, very committed to your job, Mike. But where does this one rank in all of the big games BBC Radio Manchester and yourself have ever covered?
Do you know what? It's up there, isn't it? I've written an article this afternoon for the BBC Sport website. This is a derby, a rivalry that started with the FA Cup. Go back to 1891, Ardwick versus Newton Heath. That's Manchester City versus Manchester United. United won it 5-1, but that was in the FA Cup. Since then, 189 derby games. Not one of them, I don't think, comes close. You can look back in hindsight and you've had the 2012 Premier League game at the Etihad, which City won 1-0. And that game was set out to decide who would win the Premier League, of course, even though it did in a way. There was still a lot of drama to be had from that point in. In 2018, United came from 2-0 down to delay City winning the Premier League. But for me, there is just far too much riding on this. Not only just the first time these two have ever met in an FA Cup final, but you've got City chasing the treble. United, the only side in England to have done that, are trying to stop them doing that whilst at the same time win the double themselves after getting the League Cup earlier this year. City already Premier League champions. So you've got a real clash here where a lot is on the line. The one side is going to suffer a big loss and know maybe from Manchester United's side that the treble is within City's reach. Or if it is City to lose, then the treble's gone and they will have to focus on the Champions League. I'm not doing that down in any way, but this is a derby at Wembley. Manchester descending on London. Erling Haaland is one of those to watch, of course. He's been the star man of the season so far, record-breaking amount of goals in the Premier League. And he says he was signed by Manchester City to win the lot.
It would be unreal to make this history. I will do everything I can to make this kind of history. But it's really, it's not easy. It's two finals against two good teams that will do everything they can to try to destroy that. And they will be motivated, they will be ready. And we have to play at our best, because if we play at our best, we have a really good chance of achieving exactly that.
So that's City, but what about United, Mike?
Yeah, well, United ended the season well, didn't they? Ended it strong. They clinched third in the Premier League. Which means Champions League football next season for them. They also won their final game of the season against Fulham. So when you talk about momentum, which could be important tomorrow, City lost against Brentford, United beat Fulham. The Reds, though, have had a bit of an injury blow. Pep Guardiola said from the City side of things that everyone's fully fit. We'll wait to see if he does want to test the likes of Grealish, De Bruyne and Ruben Diaz, who have been a little bit sidelined in recent weeks with knocks and various niggles. But from the Reds side, they're going to be without Antony. And boss Erik ten Hag was hopeful the Brazilian winger would recover in time to return. He was at Old Trafford last week, had a protective boot on just to be extra safe. But now ten Hag is a little less certain.
Unlikely. Dos Santos still has a chance, but it's a really small chance. He didn't make the progress. So, what I say, still has a chance, but...
Who's picking up, Ant?
Either. Unlikely. He is available.
So United are without Martial and now possibly Antony too as well, Mike.
Yeah, so that's a blow for United. But do you know what? When you look at the stats ahead of this game, Marcus Rashford has been cruelly underwritten this season. 30 goals in all competitions for Manchester United. You know, it's Haaland-esque, but the problem is Haaland's scoring more and getting the headlines more because of the records he's breaking and how he's doing it. That Rashford's actually been kind of sidelined. He's the subplot to this. But let's not underwrite that he is fit. He can play tomorrow. You've got Bruno Fernandes, who will take the game by the scruff of his neck. He really cares about what Manchester United can do. You can see that in his emotions on the pitch, good and bad. You've got players out there who know how to win the FA Cup for United. David De Gea and Luke Shaw have both done it in the colours of the Reds 7 years ago when they were here and beat Palace in extra time. So a big day ahead. And this is, you know, the form of both sides, the form of the players within it, everything that rides on it, it just sets itself up for a truly massive, massive game in the sunshine of North London tomorrow. How are you feeling? Mate. Are you nervous?
You just made me feel 10 times worse. That's what's happened.
It is going to be exactly that, isn't it? It's part excitement. But the problem is that excitement turns to nerves. And I tell you what, there's a great quote that I always remember from Pep Guardiola, the Manchester City manager. And he said, "You are only ever nervous because you are worried about the consequences." And it's so true.
That's so true. Now, you're inside Wembley, Mike. Can I ask you to come... You're not camping there tonight. Can I ask you to come back out and come find me? Because I'm thinking it'd be nice if we recorded one of our We're Not Really Here podcasts tonight. So if you can, good. You get out of Wembley? Are you locked in?
No, I'm not locked in. I will come out and see you. I tell you what, shall we double up? Shall we get the devil's advocate involved?
Oh, really? Shall we?
Yeah, let's do it.
By the way, Mike, that is only when we find them, because we've been playing this game all afternoon and they actually genuinely are lost now. Nobody knows where they are. We've had no contact in an hour.
I hope they're okay. But
I hope they're okay.
Maybe it's an omen. Maybe it's like Manchester United. Maybe they'll go missing tomorrow.
Yes, I love that, Mike. So, yes, get yourself out of Wembley. Yeah. Come and find me. Hopefully they won't get lost. And then we're going to do a We're Not Really Here, the Devil's Advocate combined. I'm going to call it emergency podcast the night before the FA Cup.
Yes, sound the alarm. Sound the alarm.
Sound the alarm. Thank you so much to Mike Miney there. Of course, you're going to get Talking Balls coming live tonight as well from the White Horse Pub at Wembley with myself and Gaz, if he comes back. And BBC Radio Manchester will be live inside Wembley Stadium from 1 p.m. tomorrow. Kickoff for the game is 3 p.m. and you get the whole game live on the radio and via BBC Sounds if you're in the UK. Commentary tomorrow on BBC Radio Manchester and on BBC Sounds. We are the only place to be for all of the game and all of the build-up. And now, let's have some more music on BBC Radio Manchester's Born...
I'm out of control.
call off the search parties. Gaz's mum and Joe's mum, stop panicking. We found them. They've turned back up at the pub.
What?
Honestly, Gaz, I'm not going to lie. We didn't hear from you for an hour straight and we started to worry.
Well, we just definitely didn't go for a couple of pints, did we?
No, we didn't.
Did you actually get lost?
We got lost. Well, actually, it was quite a lovely day in the centre of London, wasn't it? Yeah. Busy, loads of people kicking about. We hit up all the spots.
We
were just strolling about, a bit of people watching.
Yes.
Okay. Good.
Right, well, you've got to reveal to us your third location
yet.
Of course. Now, we had loads of guesses in. Ian and Collyhurst, Alison and Heaton, Stephen Droylsden, Jez the United fan, Debin Lee...
Jez definitely got it right.
..and Caroline, who says City Till I Die...
Oh,
..have all had a guess. They've all guessed the same thing as well. So, give us your clue again and reveal us. Where were you?
I said that a lot of people were crowding round one door, taking a picture of it. And what did you say?
I said that over 8,000 people are apparently employed by this place, and one cat.
Ooh, what's the cat's name? Is it Larry by any chance?
It's Larry.
Okay.
It's Downing Street.
It's Downing Street.
Come on.
Yay. Everybody got it right as well. And then what? Then you just came back. You didn't couldn't fit in anywhere else.
Here's what we were going to do. We were going to get in touch with you and say, our next location is the place where Manchester United will be picking up the FA Cup final trophy tomorrow, just around about 5 o'clock. And we were just going to be stood outside near Wembley. We thought that'd be a bit of a laugh.
Okay, but that would also be lying to our listeners, and we don't do that here, do we? We're very honest here.
You do it every night on Talking Balls.
What, when I pretend I like you?
Yeah.
Oh,
we have fun, don't we?
These are the moments. By the way, the sun's out, by the way, now.
Is
I know
it?
It's been cold before.
Well, should we go outside in a bit then?
Yeah, get outside.
Maybe we should.
If you're just tuning in, we're currently down in London. We all travelled down this morning and we are at the White Horse Pub at Wembley. But when we originally got here, it was cold and I was
freezing.
Worried because I hadn't brought a big coat. But you're telling me it's now warm out?
The sun is now setting over at the beer garden there in Wembley. I've already seen a lot of City United fans already having a chat about the game tomorrow as well. So I think it's a little perfect spot for Talking Balls.
I think we should get outside in a bit then. Oh, and by the way, I was just speaking to Mike Miney and we've decided that we're going to do an emergency joint podcast. He's up for it.
Nice. Definitely up for it.
So Devil's Advocate and We're Not Really Here. Quick podcast to go out to everybody tonight.
Do we have to?
Yes, I do. Okay, you are contractually obliged.
You don't have to do it after the game.
No, we won't be doing it after the game.
She's
because
not
some
brave
of us,
enough.
Some
She's
of us, well, I'll be
enough.
Celebrating. Some of us will be celebrating. Some of us will be celebrating. Well, thanks, guys. I really enjoyed you getting lost in London. To be honest, it got you out of my hair for 3 hours.
What can I say, Nat? You sounded wonderful as well.
Thanks,
like,
Joe.
Like, proper building it up. This is going to be a special day tomorrow.
Yeah, it's going to be
very excited. And you've helped us get into the mood of it, Nat.
Thanks. Nice one, Nat. Cheers, mate.
You're welcome, guys. You're really welcome.
I've only
Stick
said that
around.
There's a portion of chips over there.
Yeah, yeah. I was going to say, am I having your chips?
I'm having a couple of chips.
Yeah, they're not mine. They're Emily Artex. They're Emily's. Gaz, by the way, go and have a sit down because you're on Talking Balls in an hour, all right? Yes, you've got some work to actually do. You're not just sightseeing around London.
I told you we shouldn't have had them pints, Joe. I told you.
Right, you're listening to BBC Radio Manchester as we build up to the FA Cup final. We are live from the White Horse Pub in London. We've got Talking Balls coming from 6 till 7 as well. And of course, tomorrow, all of you build up all day long. We've literally taken half the station and we brought them down to London for this momentous occasion for both of the Manchester teams. So thank you for your calls and your texts today. And thank you so much for joining me. I'm standing in for Dave Scott today and it really is a pleasure to be here. And it really is a pleasure to have all your company. We'll have loads more coming up in the next hour on BBC Radio Manchester.
Squad. Put your warm-up suit on, cause you about to get a hoop on. In this game ain't nobody
over, two times over. When I'm floating over your shoulder, I look amazing while you standing like a lost soldier. When I'm in flight, breaking some makers and I'll be hooping with the Knicks all night. Cause I be producing with Houston and running with Spree, your plus nigga, that's only on the dice. He's so nice with the peel. I'ma stay fly when I kick it and switch it to AI and Philly Field. Look at the replay if you will. He's so nice with the steals that it'll be a guarantee we gon' thrill and win every time. But I gotta get with Kobe, especially if the game's on the line. Shack up in the paint with Fisher and Horry dropping trays and Devin George hurting them off the pine. Gotta cry like a baby. Minnesota callers a Mercedes. I put him to sleep with Big KG. If I get the Sacramento Kings, with Robert and Bibby, then it'll be impossible for you to fade me. I play the game, fully in control. Hit me some threes and I'ma take it to the hole. EA Sports 2004. NBA Live, if you didn't, now you know. But I know. You think you too cold, but I think you need to go and grab your favorite squad. Put your warm-up suit on, cause we about to get our hoop on. You think you too cold, but I think you need to go and grab your favorite squad. Put your warm-up suit on, cause we about to get our hoop on.
OMAC, it's BBC Radio Manchester. I'm Natalie Pike. I'm in for Dave Scott today. And I'm coming to you live from the White Horse Pub near Wembley. And myself and Lydia, who does the social media for BBC Radio Manchester, have just been sat dancing ourselves silly to that song. And we forget that we've both got headphones on. Nobody else in the pub has any idea what we're listening to. And Gaz Drinkwater just walked past and looked at us like we were absolutely crazy women just shuffling around on a chair. But I love that song. Thank you so much for joining us today. We'll be with you until 6 p.m. and then I'll be joined by Gaz for Talking Balls from 6 till 7. Thank you for your company today. It's been a pleasure so far. We've been with you since 2 o'clock, just sat in this pub near Wembley and really, really starting to get all of the build-up and all of the excitement ahead of the huge day for Manchester tomorrow, as of course it is the Manchester Derby. Oh, my God. Oh, every time I think about it, I feel a little bit woozy and my stomach jumps. But the FA Cup final is just one of the events that's helping to make it a great couple of weeks for our hospitality industry. Greater Manchester's nighttime economy advisor, Sasha Lord, told our reporter, Michelle Addison, that after some incredibly tough times, things were starting to look brighter.
Now, how many times have I been on this programme where it's been doom and gloom over the last 3 years? But last week just gone and the following week is a colossal period for Manchester. We have got the first ever Manchester FA Cup, but you throw into that, we've got Coldplay, Arctic Monkeys, that tiny shindig called Parklife, the weekend at the Etihad, Soccer Aid at Old Trafford. And you know, as we speak now, every hotel sold out, people buying new outfits, taxis are as busy as everywhere. And yes, every bar and pub will be bouncing. They're going to be packed, especially tomorrow. It's a phenomenal moment.
How does that feel? Because as you said, we've been through, or they've been through, some pretty tough times, haven't they?
Do you know what? I'm not going to lie. It is still tough out there, but this is a bit of a respite. And I think this just highlights the importance of events for the local economy. You know, I can tell you personally, I know that forget what happens in Heaton Park, but on the exterior of Heaton Park, when you look at things like taxis and hotels and stuff, that brings in 13 million to the local economy. So throw all those extra events in, we are talking tens and tens of millions of pounds that's going to be pumped into Manchester over the next 2 weeks. And yes, especially hospitality and nighttime economy is going to benefit. So I have got a big smile on my face for every single operator and staff who found it so tough over the last few years. We are bucking the trend. When I say we, I'm talking about Liverpool as well, the North West, you know, Eurovision, that brought tens of millions of pounds into the local economy. And only a few weeks ago, the Sunday Times said that Manchester was the UK's capital of nightlife, which is fantastic. You know, it's great to see. It is still hard out there. It is still tough. Obviously, everybody knows about the escalating bills and the cost of the products and stuff. So this is a much, much needed boost. And the ironic thing about it is the train strikes that were out to cause as much problem as possible for Wembley is actually done hospitality Manchester a favour, because so many people have decided to go to Wembley and rather stay overnight in hotels in London and celebrate in London. They're all coming back on the same day in cars and coaches. So it's actually given us the boost that we needed, which is slightly ironic. I mean, obviously, everybody knows the bars, the pubs, they're all going to be bouncing tomorrow, whether you're getting giddy or whether you're commiserating. You know, it's a great moment for them. However, if you are deciding to stay in that pub or bar and you did have a restaurant booking, and you've decided to carry on in the bar or the pub, please pick up the phone and make your booking cancellation, because it's so important that you give that restaurant the opportunity to pass that table on to somebody else. And I think that's the only caveat to all the excitement that's happening over the next 2 weeks.
That's Greater Manchester's nighttime economy advisor, Sasha Lord, talking about a great couple of weeks for the hospitality industry. And aren't we pleased to hear about that? Thanks so much there to Sasha Lord for talking to our reporter, Michelle Adamson. Now, we've got some more great music coming up for you shortly. We've got some Erasure and some Miley Cyrus. But before that, let's have Eyes Closed. On BBC Radio Manchester. It's Natalie Pike with you in for Dave Scott tonight, live from the White Horse Pub in Wembley. Oh, the nerves are starting to build. How are you all? How are you feeling? Are you travelling down south? Are you watching the game in a pub tomorrow? Do let me know. It's 81333. Start your text with the word Manc. We've got Leonard in Middleton on the line. Evening, Leonard, love. How are you?
I'm all right, thank you. I'm looking forward to tomorrow. Pardon?
Oh, you are.
Say again.
Are you red or a blue, Leonard?
A red.
Oh, how was the nerves then?
I'll get over them, but I've also had a tenner and I've got 16 to 1.
On United to win?
Yeah.
Oh, you're feeling confident then. Do you think this is going to be your time? Are you going to stop City getting this treble?
Yeah, well, but if City win the treble, they'll be the second club to do it because United won it first.
Of course, Leonard, the United fans will never let City fans forget that, I'm sure. Where are you going to be watching the game tomorrow?
I'll have it on the radio.
Love, Leonard, that was the right answer. A star to you. Mike Minay will give you the full match commentary tomorrow on BBC Radio Manchester. And of course, we're here all day, Leonard, because I'm already down here and the atmosphere's starting to build and I'm seeing lots of City and United fans already. So,
have you got a ticket?
I have, Leonard, I am. I'm going to be going in tomorrow and watching the game as a fan as well.
Wow.
Well, very lucky.
Congratulations with that. I did go to Wembley in 1979. You know, when United played Arsenal?
Right.
Yeah, I did go then.
That's did they win the FA Cup that year?
No, they lost 3-2.
Oh, no. I'm sorry, Leonard. Oh, I'm sorry. You've got great memories anyways.
Right, thank you. Look after yourself.
You too, Leonard. Thanks for giving us a ring. Hope you have a lovely day tomorrow. That's Leonard in Middleton. He's giving us a ring tonight. I'd love to know, you're listening to it on the radio. You're going to sit in your garden in the sunshine and have Mike Minay telling you everything that's happening? Let me know. It's 81333. Start your text with the word man. Call, give us a call. 0800 218 2255. And here is some travel news. There's three lanes closed and it's slow on the M6 going south. That's from Junction 19, the Knutsford, to Junction 18, the Middlewich turn-off because of a camper van that's broken down. In Farnworth, the traffic lights aren't working on Long Causeway at Bolton Road, which means it is heavy. In Hollingworth, queues on the 8628 Market Street at Gunn-in traffic lights, and it's taking between 35 and 40 minutes to get through there at the moment. There's congestion to the M67 and Tintwistle. Traffic is also slow through Woolley Bridge and Mottram as traffic queues to join the A628. Now, there's been a fire at a building that has closed Outwood Road in Heal Green Cheadle. That is from Winslow Road to Cross Road. And on the public transport, minor delays on all routes through the city centre. That's on the Metrolink service at Piccadilly Gardens and at Exchange Square because emergency services are dealing with an incident. And that's your BBC Radio Manchester Travel. I'll give you more in 20 minutes.
The FA Cup Final, 1996.
Manchester United against Liverpool.
They have a great motivation now, Liverpool, simply the fact that everyone's expecting us to make the double.
It's an important game for the club, and we want to go to the final and try and win it.
To the young lads who have come in this season, you know, I don't think they need any.